This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Shut down. The Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association advising members to close their doors today. New price control changes set to take effect today. The Retail Grocers Association say prices will remain unchanged for them. We'll have all the details. I'm Dwight Strawn, and this is Morning Blend. Wake up, it's a new day.
Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of a new way. You know that it's the start of the end of the old way.
Good morning again, Bahamas. It is Tuesday, November 1st, 2022. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Don Sargent will be joining us. Also this morning, we are expecting members of the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association to join us to tell us more about what is happening today and why they made this decision. Plus, later, we're talking about your health. And if you've been told that you need to have a hysterectomy, what are your options? We've got some things you need to know. And later in Morning Blend Business, we'll get a preview of the upcoming Caribbean Investment Forum. That's all straight ahead. But first, it's time for the overnight, the latest breaking news from while we're sleeping, and the top national and international headlines this morning. In the overnight after receiving no response from the government on its proposal to changes to the price control list, the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association advising its members across the country to temporarily close their doors starting today. Minister of Economic Affairs Michael Halkidis confirming yesterday that the government will begin enforcing those changes to the price control list today. In his national address on October 11th, Prime Minister Philip Davis announced changes to price control items, including the reduction of the profit margin on price control drugs. He said this would provide additional relief to Bahamians. And he mentioned the addition of 38 categories of items to price control. The deadline for enforcement was previously released, but last night the Retail Grocers Association said because it had no conclusive response from the government to its proposals, all prices, they say they're going to keep them the same until the conclusion of the ongoing consultative process. Meanwhile, in a letter yesterday, the BPA, the Pharmaceutical Association, and President Shantia McBride writing, quote, "The association has complied with Minister Halkidis's request to offer recommendations to achieve economic relief for the nation on October 21st, 2021. This document was sent as a response to a lack of consultation from the government with the pharmacy industry on the Price Control Regulation Amendment 2022. Our document sent on October 27th, 2022 has not received a response to its contents, nor has our request for further discussion been acknowledged. Therefore, the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association has made the decision to advise its membership that it is in their best interest for pharmacies within the Commonwealth of the Bahamas to close our doors temporarily, commencing November 1st, 2022. That letter saying they value customers and will advise a reopening date as soon as possible, but they note the need to ensure patient care and request that in case of an emergency, patients contact the nearest public clinic or Princess Margaret Hospital. The association, meanwhile, recommended that the government eliminate VAT and duty on medicines and guarantee that price control officers ensure that these savings are passed on to customers. Back to the Retail Grocers Association, President Philip Enneby saying yesterday that he was hoping to hear from the government by the end of the day yesterday. Asked if grocers are prepared to carry out the changes today, he said that they're still in negotiations. The government announced a maximum 15% markup for wholesalers and a maximum 25% markup for retailers. Benneby noted that the association did what it was asked to do, make a proposal. Health Minister Dr. Michael Darville defending a proposed plan by Princess Margaret Hospital to outsource patients to Doctors Hospital. Doctors Hospital West, he asserted that a temporary relocation of patients is needed while areas of the hospital are repaired. He says the hospital's in disrepair. He says they need to renovate the hospital urgently. Meanwhile, Dr. Darville saying the government spent more than $500,000 to renovate the morgue at Princess Margaret Hospital. Renovations started in October 2021. He says it was a three-phase approach, and that the morgue was in bad shape and urgently needed repair. We told you about this yesterday, more details about a woman murdered outside her home on Johnson Road. She was shot and killed outside the home early yesterday morning after she received a phone call prompting her to go outside. Relatives identifying the victim as 42-year-old Patrice Sawyer. Chief Superintendent Michael Johnson saying officers got a call around 5 a.m. that a woman had been shot. When they arrived at the scene, they met the lifeless body of a woman lying outside her residence. Johnson saying that they received information that sometime after 5 that she had been summoned outside by a phone call. She went outside. Family members heard what sounded like 3 gunshots. When they went to look, they found her outside the residence. Police saying they are making an appeal to members of the public, especially from close-knit communities, to contact them if they have any information at all. Sawyer was the third person killed in 12 hours on New Providence. On Sunday night, police say 4 people were shot on Lightburn Avenue in the Rock Crusher area. 2 people, a woman and a man, died. That man was out on bail. On Saturday, a man also out on bail for murder was killed in the area of 6th Street after a car drove up to him and the occupants shot at him. The latest killing pushing the murder count for the year so far up to 113. Overseas, days after more than 150 Halloween revelers died in South Korea's deadliest crowd surge, a quiet but wrenching reminder of the disaster remained today. Hundreds of abandoned shoes have been laid out in neat rows at badminton court in the capital of Seoul. Police have assembled the crumpled tennis shoes, loafers, and Chuck Taylors, part of 1.5 tons of personal objects left by victims and survivors of the tragedy. They're hoping that the owners or their friends and family will retrieve them. The deadly crush in the nearby nightlife district, Itaewon, happened after tens of thousands gathered for Halloween celebrations Saturday. Part of the crowd got jammed in a narrow downhill alley between a dense row of storefronts and the district's landmark Hamilton Hotel. Partygoers were seen carrying out the wounded and the dead, while dozens of lifeless bodies covered in blankets were laid out in rows on the nearby pavement. Most of the victims were women and many of them missing shoes. While experts say this reflects the force of a crowd surge that stripped footwear from their feet in the crush. Some 250 pairs of shoes at the gym are part of a huge collection of abandoned items found in the area following the tragedy. And in Brazil's capital, still silence, deafening silence, nearly after President Jair Bolsonaro lost his bid for re-election. The usually brash right-wing leader had neither conceded defeat nor challenged the results of the country's closest political contest in more than 3 decades. Bolsonaro hadn't spoken a word to reporters camped outside the official residence or the supporters who regularly gather nearby, nor did he post on his otherwise prolific social media platforms. The only sign of protest came from Bolsonaro supporting truckers who on Sunday started blocking roads across the country. By Monday night, the Federal Highway Police reported 236 incidents in 18 states, up from 136 3 hours prior to that. Bolsonaro's rival, former president and left-leaning ex-union leader Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, won the runoff election Sunday night with 50.9% of the votes to Bolsonaro's 49.1%. It was the closest election since Brazil's return to democracy in 1985. In sports, after 1 year tryout at Atlantis Beach, adjacent to the Atlantis Resort, the Don't Blink 242 Home Run Derby is back to its home base at Montague Beach. That is set for December 17th. The event, which is growing in popularity and exposure to the tune of over 8 million viewers online, will once again feature local professionals, minor and major league hitters, going up against each other for the title of Don't Blink 242 Home Run Derby Champion. Organizers Lucius Fox and Todd Isaacs Jr., both famed professional baseball players, excited about this year's events. You can read about what they're saying in today's Guardian Sports section. Former junior national team player Rima Collins making one of the biggest decisions of her life, committing to the University of Mississippi to join Yolette coach Yo McPhee McQueen at the Ole Miss Rebels for the 2023-2024 season. The 17-year-old high school senior with the Webb School in Bell Buckle, Tennessee, representing the Bahamas in the 2019 Central Basket Under 17 Women's Championship at just 14 years old, averaging a double-double in five games. She dropped 11 points and added 10.8 rebounds and 0.8 assists per game. Read all about it in today's Guardian Sports section. In the National Football League and Monday Night Football action, for the first time this season, the Cleveland Browns put it all together and played like a complete team. Offense, defense, special teams. And on Halloween, no less, Rick Chubb rushed for two touchdowns, and Myles Garrett in Cleveland's defense frustrated Joe Burrow as the Browns thrashed Cincinnati 32-13, keeping the Bengals star quarterback winless against them. And from Major League Baseball, Game 3 of the World Series was washed out, a rainout. Game was postponed until today, pushing the fall classic back one day with both teams, the Philadelphia Phillies and the Houston Astros, tied at one apiece. Again, game three set for tonight following that rain delay last night. That's sports, and that's the overnight. Time for your first look at weather. In your weather for today, it's high for the possibility of a few thunderstorms due to a slight uptick in mid-level moisture. High pressure will continue to dominate weather across the area today. Meanwhile, sea swells from a low-pressure system northeast of Bermuda will continue to create some locally choppy seas as they impact Atlantic-exposed shorelines through tonight. Boaters across all areas should be alert for possible waterspout activity, especially in the extreme northwest and southeast Bahamas. Beachgoers advise that there's a risk of rip currents along Atlantic exposures, as well as eastern shorelines in the southeastern Bahamas. For today, for all areas, your forecast calls for partly sunny, very warm and locally breezy conditions, with brief passing showers and a few short-lived thunderstorms, mainly over offshore waters, becoming mostly fair and a bit warm and humid, with mostly light showers and thunderstorms tonight. Expect possibly heavier downpours over portions of the extreme northwest and southeast Bahamas. For boaters, the small craft caution is currently in effect for all Atlantic exposures due to swells, as well as all islands on the southeastern Bahamas, including Acklands, Crooked Island, Inagua, Mayaguana, and the adjacent Keys. Winds east to southeast at 10 to 15 knots in the northwest and central islands, increasing to 15 to 20 knots in the southeastern Bahamas. Seas 2 to 4 feet near shore and in sheltered areas in the northwest and central islands, building 4 to 7 feet along Atlantic exposures in light to moderate northeasterly swells, as well as the southeast Bahamas. Right now, it's about 79 degrees under fair skies. Look for highs getting up to around 90 Fahrenheit, 32 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 77 Fahrenheit, 25 Celsius. That's your first look at weather this morning. We'll have your extended outlook and look at the tropics coming up after traffic in just a bit. It is time for a break, but when we come back, we're discussing the day's top stories right here on Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9, your home for fresh news and smart talk all day.
To think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem, just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
Technology serves to make our lives better, so why not your business too? At Custom Computers, we've been maintaining our knowledge and relationships with top tech companies since 1987 and carry only the most trusted brands like Apple, Microsoft, HP, and more. No company has helped more businesses build reliable IT systems than Custom Computers. You name it, we've done it. Call 396-1101 to talk to any of our business experts. Find trust in your tech. Count on Custom Computers.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of a new way. You know that. Yeah. It's the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day. Yeah.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for your smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at morningblend969 or facebook.com/morningblend969. Text us 422-4796 on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC. Standard text rate supplied. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Don Sargent will be joining us. Coming up this morning, we've got a lot to talk about. The Pharmaceutical Association says they are not going into work today. They are shutting down their pharmacies because they didn't get a response from the government on their suggestions to deal with the many issues that are facing them and other retailers and wholesalers. We're going to talk with the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association today about that, why they decided to go this direction. That's coming up later. We're going to be talking about your health. And if you've been told that you need to have a hysterectomy, what should you do? We've got some options that you need to consider. And later, a Morning Blend business. The Caribbean Investment Forum is just a few days away. We'll get a preview of what that's all about this year and what you need to know. So a lot to get to on this Tuesday morning. But let's begin. It's the first day of November. Can you believe that? Let's begin, though, with the latest of what's in the news. In the news, two big stories. So the pharmacies shut down. The Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association advising members to close their doors. New price control changes expected to take effect today. And the Retail Grocers Association, they're saying they're not changing their prices. So two big issues. Let's begin with the Pharmaceutical Association. We'll call them the BPA going forward. And this is the statement they released yesterday. Temporary store closure. The association has complied with Minister Halkidis's request to offer recommendations to achieve economic relief for the nation on October 21st, 2022. This document was sent as a response to a lack of consultation from the government with the pharmacy industry on the Price Control Regulation Amendment 2022. Our document, sent on October 27th, 2022, has not received a response, nor has our request for further discussion been acknowledged. Therefore, the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association has made the decision to advise its membership that it is in their best interest for pharmacies within the Commonwealth of the Bahamas to close our doors temporarily, commencing November 1st, 2022. We value our customers and will advise of a reopening date as soon as possible to provide your customers with the excellent service they deserve. We note the need to ensure patient care and request that in case of an emergency, patients contact their nearest public clinic or Princess Margaret Hospital. We hope that you unite with us in this movement, and God bless the Bahamas. That's from President Shantia McBride of the BPA, the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association. So that's what they said, and people have seen it all over social media, pharmacies, big ones, medium-sized ones, small ones, all saying they won't be open today. As a result of that, the government issued a statement of what you can do in these private pharmacies if they are not open today. So the statement from the Ministry of Health and Wellness saying that in the wake of the recent announcement by the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association, the Ministry of Health and Wellness wishes to advise the public that the following clinics will be available for the accessibility of pharmaceutical drugs. Elizabeth Estates Clinic from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. Flamingo Gardens Clinic from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. Fleming Street Clinic from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. South Beach Health Center from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Exuma Primary Care Center, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Family Island residents should visit their community clinics for all pharmaceutical needs as usual. That message from the Ministry of Health. All right, so that's happening there, and the Retail Grocers Association saying they also sent a proposal, and they've had no conclusive response from the government to this, and all prices, as a result, will remain unchanged until the conclusion of the ongoing consultative process. That's from their president. And we'll read more about what he's saying as well. So just a lot happening today. So the retail grocers president, Philip Benneby, is saying that he was hoping to hear from the government by the end of the day yesterday. He said, quote, "We were hoping to hear something today since we didn't hear anything on Friday. They were hoping that today would have been the day that we get a formal response. But up to this point, it is almost 5 p.m. and nothing is forthcoming." Asked if grocers are prepared to carry out the changes today, he said, quote, "All I can say is that we are in negotiations." What do they say? "As long as you are in negotiations, everybody stay still until the negotiations are completed." They didn't come back and say that we are not satisfied with your proposal, or you need to change something, or some alterations need to be made. Like I said, it was not even acknowledged. So that is Get Your Reaction. As we said, the BPA, we're expecting them this morning to join us. That should be in about half an hour or so. But let's hear what you have to say about this. They were on the show 2 weeks ago outlining all of their concerns. They were shocked by what they heard the Prime Minister say, because there was no consultation. Nobody said a word to them. They found out when we all did. And that took them by surprise, to say the least. And they've been trying to have meetings. They sent their proposal and not even acknowledged, as you heard, the Retail Association having the same response. But now what? What say you on this action? Pharmacies, the private pharmacy is going to be closed today. Is this the way to get the message across, or too extreme? What say you? 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796, 422-4796, text us this morning. All right, let's see, we've got some of your text messages coming in already. I don't know if I can read this one on the air, but yeah, no, it looks like they will be closed today. So whatever you need, you won't have to wait till tomorrow. And if it's important, you'll have to go to one of the government clinics or the pharmacy, the hospital. And, you know, that's going to be special. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. All right, so more on what they're saying here. And this is both sides. And, the BPA wrote to Halkidas last week and insisted that new price control regulations specific to the pharmacy sector are untenable and not sustainable for the sector to operate for any length of time. The association recommended that the government eliminate value-added tax and duty on medicines and guarantee that price control officers ensure that the savings are passed along to customers. At the beginning of the year, the government added 10% VAT to medicines and also to breadbasket items, a move that proved controversial even though it reduced VAT on everything else from 12 to 10%. And as they said, they are working with razor-thin margins, and it's a struggle to do business, and that while some of the bigger companies might be able to make it with what's being proposed by the government, the smaller ones will struggle. They may have to lay off people or close their doors permanently. Let's see what you have to say. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, Mr. Strawn.
Hi, good morning.
Yeah, I'm listening to your show very closely this morning. And, you know, I think I'm in agreement with the government on this one, because I remember when they reduced the VAT to 10%, the stores increased their prices by more than 2%. So the benefits of the VAT decrease were not passed on. And all the government's trying to do is to say, well, if we're going to make a sacrifice and reduce our VAT income, hoping to grow it, the economy, then they shouldn't try to bump it up. Those guys are being greedy.
Now, you say that, but are you certain that those prices didn't increase because of what's happening globally with inflation, with the war in Ukraine, with the global challenges?
Those price increases started Right after that was done, and at the time that was done, there was no global challenge. There was no.
No, there certainly was, sir. We've been in the pandemic for 2 and something years, so there absolutely was the global challenge. That's been going on for a couple years now.
Okay, let's consider there was a global challenge, and let's consider there was a supply chain. I don't think that at the time, their stock that they had in office warranted them to make the increase so quickly and immediately.
Mm-hmm. They'll disagree with you.
They made it almost immediately.
Yeah, they'll disagree with you vigorously on that one.
They probably would, but I think the government has the upper hand on this one, in the sense that the public would understand better what the government's saying and trying to do. Because at the same time, too, now, they also said that if they're going to put the VAT on the breadbasket items, they're going to also increase the social services payments, which they did. So, you know, we can't all expect you to have it both ways and to screw the government over every time. You've got to be able to join the government hand in hand to make the sacrifice required. And consider this, a lot of the breadbasket items that we're talking about, when the analysis is made, it demonstrates that people at the lower level don't even purchase those items. Those items, breadbasket items, are benefiting the Wendy's who buy all the bread and the people who buy the stuff for KFC and... Well, sorry, I don't mean to call a company
name.
Yeah,
please don't.
But they will get huge benefits from those items. So now government's just trying to say, you've had it all along now, and let's retrench, and let's reconsider, and let's revamp. If we're going to grow our economy, there's some things we got to do, and I think that they're moving in the right direction with it.
Okay, I hear you.
Okay.
Thanks a lot. Folks who are importing themselves, who are going and buying stuff abroad and bringing it in, can tell you that prices have changed. And that in many regards, it doesn't make sense to buy from abroad anymore with the increase in prices. And then the VAT. And then the other VAT. Got at least 2 VATs before it comes to you. So, you know, you could say that. But is that really what happened? Let's take another call. Good morning, call. You're on the air.
Morning. How are you?
Good morning.
Morning. How are you?
Doing well. Good morning.
I'm not so in agreement to vote with the government is doing, right? But I'm more in favor of the family services, not the fact that I want persons who plan who are not going to be able to get the medication due to the government's limits, wouldn't have the supply, okay? What the government should do, they should sit down with them and discuss on how they're going to take the back those medications. Maybe that will be a cure. Because for a long day, was discussing on taking part of medication. So I feel like this is the time when they could do it now, you know, in both parties. Then. Take the part of the medication, mm-hmm. You know.
Okay.
Then you can't write on no medication. Take it off completely. That's just my sense on that.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Dawn, is Dawn on? Yep. Dawn, good morning. Welcome to the show.
Morning, Dwight.
Hi. Yeah, let's get your reaction to this. We'll get back to the calls in a bit. What do you make of what you're waking up to?
Oh, yes. I mean, with the certain pharmacies being closed, is this everybody or just certain ones?
We'll see. We'll see. But some have announced that they won't be open today. Some major ones have announced already.
They won't be open when?
Today. Mm-hmm.
Is it just... how long is this lasting? Is this indefinitely or is this like a...
They're saying temporarily, but we don't know.
So it's indefinitely until their demands are met.
Well, we don't know how long, but beginning today.
Okay, sure. I mean, I don't know how to feel about it because I don't know who to trust and believe. I do not trust private interests in this country, and I simultaneously don't trust the government. So I don't know who's telling the truth and who's lying in this case. I'm sure some of the callers will have different perspectives than me, but I think this is a wait-and-see situation. I need to actually read more. Because I was unaware that pharmacies were impacted by this. I just was bread
basket. Oh, Don, you need to listen to Morning Blend when you're not on. That would help you. You'll go a long way. Very long way. They were here 2 weeks ago and spoke at length of all the challenges.
I didn't listen to that episode.
Yeah, that's unfortunate.
But I was aware of the situations with the food center. I was following that extraordinarily closely. So when I saw the announcements yesterday evening of pharmacies, I was taken a bit by surprise. I was like, huh? But I understand, I guess, everybody's kind of position, but I don't know who to trust, if that makes any sense. And I remember under the last administration where we had VAT on off of medicines and medical procedures, and I remember having to pay lots of money right before they made that amendment to essentially make those things tax-free. So I don't know. I don't really have a perspective or position on it because, again, like I don't know who to trust in this instance.
I mean, I don't know, I don't know if that's the right word to be using here. I think everybody has some very valid points on all sides. Everybody.
No, I'm not saying that the points aren't valid. Yeah. I just don't know.
But trust isn't the right word. But everybody.
I think for me it is. I don't because I remember sharing the same situation about the situation with gas stations saying that they were going to close on imminently, that they would have to take action. In response to the government refusing to raise the margins, and they drummed up the beats that we were going to go to business and things are going to be terrible, and then we're still alive. So I don't know. That's why I'm saying that. And I'm not taking up a position against them or for them. Just I have to look and see what's going to happen.
Yep. All right. Let's take another call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Dwight.
Hi.
And good morning, Don. And good morning to those who wake up in the land of the living. I hope you had something hot on your chest. Dwight, you know something? What is so funny is that when the rich, you know, the rich, the mega rich, the people who have the big merchants, the big stores, the big pharmacies, when you see the government, any government, past, present, or future, touch when it comes to their monies, Or when it comes to their businesses, you hear them cry out. But the funny part about it, Mr. Strawn, is that you don't hear the rich cry out for the poor, you know. You don't hear the rich cry out for the less fortunate.
I don't know if you can say that, DeWitt.
Listen to me, sir. I heard you said something to a gentleman a little earlier, I mean, on the first caller, right? Do you realize that in this country, where you come every day on the radio talk show, you know how much millions and millions and millions of dollars these food merchants and pharmaceuticals people make off the people? You know how much millions of dollars they make, Dwight?
All right. So everybody needs to calm down right now, right? Everybody just calm down. So there are some huge companies. Yes, absolutely. And you're not paying attention to what's going on. The smaller companies, the smaller ones are the ones who are saying, we are going to suffer. They have maybe 4 or 5 employees. They're not the big names. And you know who the big names are in the pharmaceutical sector and in the grocery sector, right? You know who they are. We're talking the smaller ones, the moms and pops and the little ones. They got 1 or 2 stores. They're the ones who are saying, we're going to have a problem because the minimum wage is going up. And at the same time, the electricity rates are going up. The price margin, the margin is going down. Prices are already higher because of global issues, and it's the perfect storm for them to collapse. That's what they're saying. The big ones, don't be blinded by the light. The little ones are the ones who are saying, we are going to be the ones who are going out of business, and all you will have will be the big ones. And then what are you going to do? Because they get to really control things. Pay attention. So I know everybody's angry with big business and they're all they want to do is take advantage of us. Maybe, but it's the little ones here that are saying what the government's hoping to do, which everybody agrees something has to be done. The cost of living in this country is gigantic. But they aren't going to be able to handle all of this at one time. That's what they've been saying, right? Okay, now that I've given you a little summary, let's talk sensibly. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us. 422-4796. And as we said, the BPA will be here to defend themselves and explain themselves. We have a lot of questions. A lot of people who are going to need medication today and do not want to go to the hospital and don't want to go to any government clinic. And they need that medication today. Is it fair for this to be happening now? We'll ask them that question when they get here. But let's talk sensibly. Let's put the political colors down and your hatred of big business and capitalism and all that. Yep, let's put that aside. Let's talk like real people because not all of these people are big and rich. They have tiny little businesses and they're trying to do a little thing in a community pharmacy or community supermarket.
So are you saying, Dwight, that we should do something specifically, in this case, or the government should, for small businesses.
Everybody
to support them.
Everybody, no, I'm not saying that. But
I mean, if you were, I don't think you'd get a lot of people disagreeing with you.
At least acknowledge the people where they send you some suggestions. Say, we're going to look at it. Let's continue to talk. Something. Don't just ignore and expect things to go right. I mean, that's rude. It's just plain rude. But with what the government's trying to do is noble. It sounds great. But at what cost? All right, let's talk. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Dwight and Dawn.
Hi.
Hey, Dwight. I'm definitely not in support. I'm supporting the pharmaceutical people because why? The hospitals, right, and the clinics, right. If you ever been to one of the clinics and after seeing a doctor, right, and they prescribe two medication, you could guarantee one of them ain't inside. So you almost have to go to a private pharmacy to get your prescription filled, right? So it can really be a problem, right? Because a lot of people really can't who need their medication. They can't get them at no government clinic. So the government really need to get their act together, right? Because we can't continue with this status quo situation in this town, man, right? These guys have to try to come up to the plate and do some things that we could live by. Because see these business people, they are business people, right? And they be there when don't care who government in power. Right, and they and like you just indicated, everything is showing where things are rising, light and of course the living, everything is rising. So how the leaders are not putting those escalation and costs, right, and what they are suggesting people to do, man, you know, it ain't adding up to me.
Okay,
try something nice.
Thank you very much. Let's take another call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Dwight.
Hi.
Dwight, in all the greatest respect to you and the guests, right? I have been on your talk show, sit in your studio. I call your talk show. The simple fact is I feel that as a Bahamian, not politics, I have enough people that I meet, they admire that my contribution. But Dwight, I have never disrespected you, right? You might not agree with things I might say. I might not agree with things. But to hang the phone up on me, Dwight, is all good, you know. But I'm just trying to show you how humble I am. I'm a humble person, first of all, and I'm a humble PLP. So you have a nice morning, my brother.
Thank you. You too. I just want you to be focused, and you have disrespected me before, so let's not do that. But anyway, thank you for being humble this morning. But I just need you to be focused. 323-622-3232-325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. All right. Let's go to the text line. This person says here, thank God we still have two of the three addictions still providing services. Don't know what we will do without the drugs, but we will still have our liquor and food. Okay, this is not a joke, folks. But anyway, sure. Yes, doctors, hospitals, pharmacy will remain open. Yes, I think that is correct. I saw that. Another one here. This is an opportune time for the government to stock pharmacies and to help with these local pharmacies. Well, I had a very interesting experience a few days ago to get some medication for my mom. She's on the drug plan, NHI, right? Don, you listening to this? So the last time I went to fill one of the prescriptions, they told me they didn't have it. They said they're hoping to get a shipment in by the end of the week. That was last week. All right. So I went back. No, I called, and I told them the drug, and they said, is this private or NHI? I said, NHI. And they're like, oh, no, we don't have any. I'm like, oh, okay. What about your other locations? No, they still don't. We're still waiting. I'm like, oh, boy. Okay, earlier you said private NHI. Why did you ask me that? Oh, because NHI, we don't have it, but if it's our stuff, we have it, private. What? What are you saying? They say, well, the NHI stuff, that's what the government pays for. their stuff, we don't have it. But if you're buying,
so what they're saying,
if
to
you're buying,
is,
we have it.
Put some money in insurance, but if you poor, then too bad, die.
I wouldn't put it like that, but the government.
No, I would. I would.
The government supply was out, but if you buy it, they had it. I'm like, what madness is this?
That's a pretty clear message. I don't know what you want them to draw a picture to show you.
Because I mean, days had gone by, and they're like, "Oh, we don't have it." I'm like, "Oh boy, this is life saving medication." We're down to like 2 tablets.
Yes, it's life-saving if you have money. If you don't, then die.
So
that's what it translates to.
The reason
this played in the United States as well. So, I mean, I'm not trying to be petty here.
Well, here's the thing. The reason I brought that up was because if you're waiting for the government stuff, you could have a problem. But if you have money, well, it goes back to what you're saying. You'll be okay. It's very scary. So in a situation like this where the private pharmacies are closed and you have to go to the public pharmacies, they aren't always going to be stocked. And that is going to be a challenge, I'm sure. So that's scary. That was scary and quite an eye-opener. I didn't think that's how things worked around here, but I should have known better, I guess. Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Hello, good morning, Dwight and Gat.
Good morning.
Just one clarification. The prescription drug plan is provided by the National Insurance Board. NHI does not provide pharmaceuticals.
Not technically under NHI. Okay, all right, so NIB, NHI. All right, so is it not, this is not an instance when I can say potato, potato? No?
No, you can't. Okay. They're two distinct things.
Okay.
As I said, the prescription drug plan is provided by NIB, whereas NHI does not cover pharmaceuticals at this time.
At this time. Okay. Still a scary situation, though.
It is. It is.
Yeah.
And we hope for the best in it.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you for clearing that up. NIB, not NHI. Sure. All right. Oh, boy, more of your text messages. This one says, hey, watch the PLP and the trolls try to demonize the pharmaceutical companies. It's common business sense. You can't cut my profits but still raise minimum wage. The cost of electricity is going up, plus inflation. Some company under because of this. This person says here, how laughable of a statement from the pharmaceutical spokespersons. They care about their customers. Will customers pay more and close the door on them instead of working with the government to help all involved during this difficult times? Okay, I think some word is missing there, but you get what they're saying.
So I have to ask then, it has, again, I'm not taking sides on this, but I'm trying to get a better understanding, and I'm sure some members of the public are too. Is it that they, because I'm sure they spoke with the government, I would hope that they did, and is it that the government didn't budge, or that like just absolutely just a breakdown in communication and we led to this situation? How do we get to the nuclear option where they just shut their doors and call it a day? Like, how did we get here?
That's what they said, Don. They met. They said, give us a proposal. They sent the proposal, and there was no response.
I need Clint to explain this. I'm confused.
Okay. This person says, they said for months when VAT went down, prices went up. They got used to the big profit. Businesses were greedy. Where is price control? Okay, I'm not sure if that's right. But anyway, this latest action by the pharmaceutical companies is much too extreme. What sick people will do, what will sick people do who need their medications? What do they have to do with this? This is just an evil approach. This person says, if it were my business and I had to run a business on what the government's trying to do, I would push back also. The government's trying to take their business or use them to get votes. This one says here, I'm not in the pharmacy industry, but we need to be careful about having people make ignorant comments on this matter. I saw many comments, and a caller just now is clear that they don't even understand the issues the pharmacies are having. I am in support of the pharmacies. Another one here. We, the payment people, support the pharmacies. I hope the grocery stores take the same stance and close their doors. Oh, boy. You cannot have dictatorship in a democracy. Truckers, bus drivers should do the same. They are pushing a very expensive CDL training down their throats. Oh, that's the commercial driver's license. Well, Another one here. Humble people don't need to say they are humble. It should be self-evident. Okay. Just tuned in. I remember previous... Okay. Yeah, let's move on. We don't have to talk about the callers, folks. Let's not do that. This person says here, does this not go against the oaths that pharmacists take? Do they take things like the doctors? I don't know. I'm sure things can be ironed out with big pharma. However, how many people are going to suffer? All these big companies made millions during COVID. Now the bottom line is being affected. Now they want to close their doors. They need to reflect on the oath they took. Mm-hmm. Okay. This person's calling me rude for hanging up on people. Okay. Morning, gents. How are you all doing this morning? What? Just for the what? No, doc. Government pharmacies don't acknowledge private pharmacies' prescription refill labels. They don't. Well, I guess you need to have the original prescription, right? I don't know. And this one says here, the scenario described is not as straightforward as that. NIB contracts specific drugs, and the pharmacy is not permitted to substitute drugs. I didn't say that anything about that. I mean, this is the same drug, but NIB didn't have it. But the pharmacy did. And same pharmacy talking to me. So it seemed pretty straightforward to me. And we were down to 1 to 2 tablets. So I had to buy it. It wasn't too expensive, thank God. But I mean, like Don says, some people won't be able to buy it. And it's sitting right there in the pharmacy. So... that's disturbing. Very disturbing. Let's take some calls before we have to take a break. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning, Dwight, and good morning to your co-host.
Hi.
Dwight, you know, I have to borrow a statement from the His Majesty Official Opposition, the leader of Mr. Michael Pintad. Evidence and database decision. That's what is lacking and what has happened over the last few weeks. The problem we also have is that none of this would be an issue if you had economic growth to substantiate the demand that is being made by government. Because even if are lower and consumption increases, then they would not be affected based on the volume. The problem is we have a diminishing economy in spite of what the central bank governor says. You know, I've heard he says that we don't have inflation in the Bahamas. I don't know if people have used the word yet. But the mere fact that we import inflation and the fact that everything around the world is going up, call it by another name, it still arose the same. And so I think it's important now that if we have to decide, do we want a socialist economy or do we want a capitalistic economy? Capitalist economy as we so often promote. So what the government now needs to do, the urgency of action requires us to lay out a strategy beyond the plan, beyond the ideas, actual strategies of how we will grow the economy, diversify the economy by diversifying into tourism and other different things, so that the individuals will not be impacted, so we don't have to rob Peter to pay Paul. Because wage increase, do we have to grow to support that in the economy, or are we just returning different money? Do we have the? Are we in a position to say we're going to dictate profits to individuals who we flip-sidedly tax, because we tax their gross as opposed to income tax across the board for businesses and individuals? It seems as if we're trying to buy paint for this broken-down house as opposed to building a new foundation. You know, I think that the conversation should shift as these individuals, these businesses work with the government to solve their issues. I think it's incumbent upon the citizens to begin to demand from their individual members of parliament, not just screaming at the band, but the economic strategy that shows the growth, to show that even where small businesses can enter these markets from a competitive nature to provide to need, because this is the opportunity, crisis provides opportunity. And so the problem is that we're not hearing anything from government. For 1 year, we heard marketing. I think we heard a lot of things from this from the leader of opposition at the march that the some demands that we didn't carry. And I think it's time for us to broaden the conversation to the level of accountability for what we do, what's now, what's new, and what's next. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's start calling individual MPs and start asking from them, what is your answer, what is your plan, individually and collectively? Thank you so much.
Okay. Well, I guarantee you're going to feel more lost than you're feeling right now if you wait for that. Let's take this final call, and then we've got to take a break. Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Turn on your radio for us, please.
Is that me?
Yes. Yes, you're on. Turn on your radio, please.
Okay. Godly, I cannot hear you over the telephone, Dwight, but what I want to say, right, Godly David, you know, it's along with you and Don. Hello?
Hi, yeah, we can hear you.
Good. What I want to say, right, when it comes, something needs to be written up by NIB and the government to the pharmacies, whereby if the pharmacies doesn't have enough for what government had written up for, then it should be given to the people by the pharmacists and then give the receipt to the government. That's the proper way to do something if you're thinking properly. Thank you for your time.
Okay. All right. We'll ask the BPA what they think about that. We'll ask them that question. We're going to take that call, and then we've got to go. Caller, good morning. You're on the air. Turn on your radio.
Sir. Good morning to all.
Hi, good morning.
You know, people want to believe that the government don't have the government do business licenses, so they know all the sales. So therefore, they should know all the sales of these companies, right? They also do NIB, so they should know all of their payroll. You see, government knows. Government's not like I and you. You see, government have all the receipts, you know, and they know the numbers, you know. They know the data, you see. So, and then, some, you know, one person says, well, we got to decide whether we're going to be a dictator or what, democracy. Come on, man, socialist countries are democratic countries. Argentina, look at what you call it, you know, Brazil has a progressive government today, you know, but PLP is a progressive government, you know, and what happens when, and look at medicine is essential, food is essential, okay, we know that we just had a pandemic and these things were essential, these shops couldn't close down, and what happens if, just like, what happens if the government decides to sell essential goods?
Okay, thank you very much, caller. We're getting our news from different sources. Argentina and Brazil are examples I would certainly not use to talk to what we need to be doing around here. But okay, but that's great. I appreciate your opinion. Let's take a break. When we come back, we will talk to the BPA. We'll find out exactly what they are hoping to accomplish right after this. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9.
What can I do when you're out of sight, in my mind?
Watch out.
'Cause sometimes I look in.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
This is AP News. I'm Rita Foley. At least two drive-by shooters opened fire in a Chicago neighborhood on Halloween night, injuring as many as 14 people, say police. The AP's Donna Warder.
Police Superintendent David Brown says there are three young victims, ages 3, 11, and 13. The other victims range in age from their 30s to 50s. Brown says the conditions of the victims range from non-life-threatening injuries to critical condition. I'm Donna Warder.
No known. A popular Halloween celebration in Omaha, Nebraska turned frantic when a man drove through a barricaded area last night and was shot and wounded by police. One neighborhood resident says she heard gunshots, and then she says everybody just started screaming and running and crying. An investigation's underway. A court hearing today for the man accused of attacking House Speaker Nancy Pelosi's husband, Paul, David DePapp. Prosecutors will ask that he be held in jail without bail on state charges. The AP's Sagar Magani reports he also faces federal charges.
Federal charges have been filed against the man who broke into House Speaker Nancy Pelosi's California home Friday, and police say his goal was to hold her hostage. Court papers say David DePapp found a sleeping Paul Pelosi in a bedroom before he beat the 82-year-old in the head with a hammer. The affidavit reveals DePapp told police he wanted to talk with Nancy Pelosi. If she lied, he would break her kneecaps. They say he explained she would then have to be wheeled into Congress, which would show other lawmakers there are consequences to actions. Sagar Magani, Washington.
You still Powerball jackpot is now $1.2 billion. Game 3 of the World Series is tonight. This is AP News. The latest on the war in Ukraine now. The AP's Charles de Ledesma has this.
Experts from the International Atomic Energy Agency are conducting inspections of two sites in Ukraine where Russia alleges dirty bombs are being manufactured. IAEA Chief Rafael Grossi says inspectors have begun and would soon complete verification of the two sites. The inspectors have been requested by Kiev senior officials. The Kremlin's made unfounded accusations that Ukraine's preparing to use a so-called dirty bomb, an explosive laden with radioactive materials. Western nations, however, have rejected as transparently false the Kremlin claim. Ukrainian authorities dismissed it as an attempt to distract attention from Moscow's own alleged plans to detonate a dirty bomb. I'm Charles de Ledesma.
Millions of Americans can start choosing their 2023 health insurance plans on healthcare.gov today. I'm Rita Foley, AP News.
Got your first look at traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC. For all of life's moments, there's one, the Visa Classic credit card. A reminder of the work going on at Village Road and Shirley Street, and work continues on Boyd Road as well. So those are causing some issues. Right now, in your real-time traffic, we're seeing traffic backed up a bit. On Eastern Road, heading into Shirley Street near Village Road, and that's extending all the way to Fox Hill Road. It's manageable at this hour, but the building, definitely. Elsewhere, we're seeing the usual heavy traffic on Milo Butler Highway from just south of Fire Trail all the way up to Tonic Williams Darling Highway. And south of Fire Trail, the traffic builds on Gladstone Road northbound all the way up to JFK Drive. Building traffic on Carmichael eastbound to Blue Hill Road, and Blue Hill seeing some issues, especially near St. Vincent Road and near Carmichael. And just north of Soldier on the way over to Independence Drive. Got some pockets along Bernard Road as well, especially near the schools in the area and the intersection of Bernard Wolf Village and Soldier, looking a little busy for you at this hour. But that's what we're seeing so far. We'll have another update for you after the 8 o'clock news. That's your Morning Blend Traffic Alert, brought to you by RBC, reminding you that you can experience cashless purchasing power and chip and pin security with your RBC Visa Classic credit card. Manage your day-to-day expenses and apply today at rbc.com/Caribbean/Visa Classic. And we've got another check of your weather for today. We've got the possibility of a few thunderstorms due to a slight uptick in the mid-level moisture, but high pressure will be the dominant weather feature across the country. Sea swells from a low pressure system just northeast of Bermuda will continue to create some locally choppy seas as they impact Atlantic exposed shorelines through tonight. For all areas today, look for partly sunny, very warm, and locally breezy conditions with a brief passing shower or two, and a few short-lived thunderstorms, mainly over offshore waters today, becoming mostly fair and a bit warm and humid with mostly light showers tonight. Expect possibly heavier downpours over portions of the extreme northwest and southeast Bahamas. Small craft cautions in effect for all Atlantic exposures due to swells, as well as all islands in the southeast Bahamas, including Acklands, Crooked Island, Inagua, Mayaguana, and the adjacent Keys. Temperatures today getting up to 32 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down about 77 Fahrenheit, 25 Celsius. In your extended outlook, drier air moving across the country will gradually dampen significant weather chances as high pressure persists and sea swells will temporarily subside, allowing for more favorable maritime conditions through Thursday. So for tomorrow, Wednesday, partly sunny to sunny, warm and breezy with brief passing showers and a slight chance of isolated thunderstorms. Thursday, mostly sunny and warm with a few light showers. We'll have a look at the tropics and Tropical Storm Lisa. I'll tell you all about that after the 8 o'clock news. We'll have more Morning Blend after these messages here on Guardian Radio 96.9.
Are you an attorney with a joint practice operating from one location? Accepting payments from clients doesn't have to be complicated.
Introducing RBC MultiPay. Now each attorney can securely accept and settle payments with one point-of-sale device supporting multiple bank accounts.
With competitive pricing, training, and easy up and running in no time.
Call 356-8500 to sign up for RBC MultiPay.
I just link up with this beautiful young lady and she say she in love with me. She say even my internet making sense. When she come over, she say my signal strong, my movies enriching, and when she use her computer, everything was smooth. The only problem is, I let her meet me by my boy house that day, and he got that BTC fiber internet speed bump.
Current fiber internet bundle customers now have as much as 3 times the speed. Totally free. Link up with BTC.
Are you an attorney with a joint practice operating from one location? Accepting payments from clients doesn't have to be complicated.
Introducing RBC MultiPay. Now each attorney can securely accept and settle payments with one point-of-sale device supporting multiple bank accounts.
With competitive pricing, training, and easy setup, you will be up and running in no time.
Call 356-8500 to sign up for RBC MultiPay.
Interest on your savings at the bank? With as little as $100, you can start earning interest on your money while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank with the SeaCloud Savings Express plan. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 on interest there too. Because at SeaCloud, your interest is our interest. Visit SeaCloud.com to start now. SeaCloud, growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians. We know how important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, we're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches. If you are exposed to COVID-19, have symptoms, get tested so that you can have peace of mind about your status. Just visit one of our convenient locations on New Providence at the University of the Bahamas or Golden Gates Plaza, weekdays 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Saturdays 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. On Eleuthera at the Three Island Dock, Mondays through Thursdays 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Fridays and Saturdays 8 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Sundays 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. On Exuma at the Agarda Park, weekdays 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Saturdays 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Sundays 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. On Abaco at Maxwell Food Store, Mondays through Saturdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. The COVID-19 test results will be ready in 15 minutes, and the tests are free.
This message is brought to you by PAHO WHO and the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
When one says Rust-Oleum, one thinks Bahamian paint. Bahamian paint carries over 150 different Rust-Oleum spray products. I'm talking products like Rust-Oleum's textured finishes, you know, the leather effect, the antique look, or the hammered finish. Now we're talking about Rust-Oleum's tub and tile paint, chalkboard paint, and the dry erase board and a can paint, the Invertible foundations, and of course the granddaddy of Rust-Oleum's rust-fighting family, Rust-Oleum's 9100 heavy-duty the anti-corrosion coating that gives metal unmatched protection against the elements. That's why when one says Rust-Oleum, one thinks of Bohemian Paint. Howard Road and Mackey Street. Right now, get 20% of all cash sales through December 24th.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
Welcome back to Morning Plant Hill and Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strong along with Don Sargent. And we pick up our conversation about the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association advising members to close their doors. In studio with us now, we have President Shantia McBride and BPA member Shagrega McPhee. Ladies, welcome. Shantia, welcome back to the show. Great to have you with us.
Thank you.
All right. So you were here 2 weeks ago, and there was a bit of optimism. We were hoping that you'd be able to get the government to understand what you were facing, and it seemed that you made your case. This is a surprising outcome. We saw the post yesterday. How did we get to this point? What has happened?
Okay.
Or what hasn't happened?
So a little bit of history, as you indicated, we were here 2 weeks ago. So as the nation would recall, on October 12th, the government indicated that there would be price control amendments on markups to various items, pharmaceutical items. During that time, the pharmaceutical industry felt as if it should have been with consultation with our industry, and therefore we started our lobbying to the government, asking to meet with the Prime Minister and Minister Akitas. And to that end, we had a meeting first with Dr. Dava, which we were thankful for. Then we met with Minister Akitas. That would have been the 21st of October. At that time, during our conversation, we requested information as to where these markups came from.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What was the government's plan for pharmacy in their decision for the amendments, and how we can now collaborate to give economic relief to the nation.
Mm-hmm.
So during our conversation with Minister Akitas, it was not elaborated to the association as well as we wish to get our information as to what was done, what survey was done, what information was brought back to the minister, and why pharmacy was not consulted. So in that, we also asked Minister Akitas what now can be done. We're now at the table. How would he like pharmacy and the government to now work together?
Mm-hmm.
We were asked to send back recommendations to his office, how we can bring about economic relief. Those recommendations that, as I indicated, that would have been October 21st. So it would be our belief now that we are in consultation period with mm-hmm. the government.
Mm-hmm.
However, on that following Tuesday, Minister Akitas indicated that the enforcement of those amendments would take place on November 1st. We were still within our body coming up with the recommendations. They were still sent to Minister Akitas despite his comments. And since that time, which would be October 27, there's been no response. We also called to find out if the minister was in receipt, if he would be responding, and if we can still be granted an interview. There was no response to that request neither.
Mm-hmm.
So at that time, I took it back to the body of the association, which would be pharmaceutical retailers, whether it be in the clinic setting or community, also our wholesalers, and during our deliberations, we decided that it was in our best interest that we would close to show our united front up in opposition of these amendments and in our opposition to sit at the table with us up to yesterday.
Okay, so some people are saying and are going to feel like this is an extreme leap. Like, why not maybe a go slow? Why not work to rule? I mean, you're private, but you know what I mean. Like, only allow certain people in the store at a time, but not all the way to a shutdown. I mean, you're dealing with life-saving medications in many regards. Why this giant jump to that?
So the challenge really is, as the minister would have actually stated, we're actually, if we do open and our prices are not changed, we will be fined. Mm. So if you're talking about a fine of a couple thousand dollars per item, that will essentially, that will essentially close some of us down today. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, none of us want to be arrested. None of us want to be closed. We actually want to be here for the public. And we hear it. We listen to it. But I think the greatest challenge that is being had is people do not understand what's happening. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people are saying, oh, but they're for profit businesses. So here's the reality. Private farms are open in order to be able to make a profit. That profit is what helps us to pay our staff, to pay our bills. We're a product-based industry. So people have to understand there's a difference between us and, let's say, you going to another business that just says, this is my price, pay my price. We actually have to purchase items from wholesalers. Those wholesalers have to purchase items from manufacturers, import them, bring them in, pay duties, pay VAT, then it comes here. Mm-hmm. Then we get it from them. So now we also have to pay that price and then do a markup. So when I now do that markup, let's say I bought my item for a dollar, I'm selling it for $1.50. When I now do that 50 markup, that has to be divided into paying my staff. That has to be divided into paying my rent, paying my electricity bill that's about to go up. What people also need to realize, when you're dealing with pharmacies, especially if you're a pharmacy that's heavy in insurances, so everybody loves to use their insurance, great, and we're happy to accept it. But the insurance company may take a month or 2 months to pay me. So now you've come in for your second or third refill, and I haven't been paid for the first month as yet. That is what we kind of need people to understand. We are not trying to hurt anybody. And that's one of the things we said. Listen, the government clinics are open. The hospital is open. And people say, oh, but they don't never have nothing.
Right.
Well, talk to your representative. This is what we need them to work on. We need to make sure that these places are sufficiently filled. But understand, we want to be here to help the public. A lot of people talked about it during COVID. We did not make millions.
Right, because we had a caller earlier who said you heard that, right?
Saying it.
You all made, you were open
millions.
This whole time.
No.
Can't you just take this little hit as a little sacrifice for
no.
now?
No, what people have to understand, because remember, we only open for partial days. So you've now taken a six-day business week, a master down to maybe about 3 days, and we were pulling hours. Many of us had swollen feet. Many of us were stressed out with anxiety, but we were there making sure our services are done. So it's the same services we would have provided during the week, but now we're down to 2 to 3 days. Mm-hmm. We did not make any extra money. And it goes back to what I said to you. We have to purchase the goods, and then you only have that small amount of money that actually has to be divided up to take care of your bills and other services.
Right, right. And I think you know, this came up last time we were here at Shantia about, you know, they're not just the big companies here. We've got some small little pharmacies in neighborhoods.
Yes.
And while the big ones can handle this, perhaps, it's the small ones.
But can they really? You don't that's even actually a misconception again. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something people have to think about. All of us. So the big companies, as you may call it, the reality is some of us may close in a month. Those bigger companies may close in 6 months. If everybody has to buy drugs and we cannot purchase the drugs, isn't that going to be a ripple down or ripple up effect, however you look at it? Everybody will be hurt. It functions. So if all of the wholesalers close down now, not one pharmacy is going to be able to be open because they cannot secure the medications. So it's not a matter of big or small. It's really just a matter of some of us will close faster than others.
Okay, explain that to people again, because a lot of folks are saying, well, if they close down just because it'll be out of spite. They have tons of money that's been around for years. Come on, it can't be that serious.
No, for us,
Shantia,
that is the misconception, as you indicated. And she said, there's small pharmacies and then there's large pharmacies. So if a small pharmacy cannot take the hit, Therefore, the bigger wholesale chains or the bigger pharmacy eventually is going to feel it. They may have two or three stores now. You may see that ripple down to only three, ripple down only two. So therefore, now those individuals that have a community pharmacy will not be yet able to go to a community pharmacy. They have to travel further distances now to probably fill their medication. And if a small pharmacy closes, it may be one or two persons that will be unemployed now. But now if it ripples to a larger pharmacy, you now increase the numbers. If it if it goes to a wholesaler, now you have numerous persons. You have staffing. Now their family, well, during COVID, many of us in pharmacy or in healthcare, we were probably the only breadwinners homes
because everybody else was closed.
So, and we maintained our staff. So at the time of maintaining our staff during COVID of 4 hours, and you wish not to decrease anyone's hours also. So some of us were actually trying to maintain salaries as best we could to that point so that families are not affected by having probably only one breadwinner in the family. So it at the end of the day, it now spreads. When our margins are decreased and I'm now 15% less in my funding for what I may get from my profit.
Something is going to have to cut.
Yes, that's 15% of my inventory or 15% of my salary, 15% somewhere that we are going to have to make cuts or make decisions on how best we're going to keep our companies going.
So what do you say to the grandmother who ran out of her prescription last night and was heading to you all today?
All of the government clinics and the hospitals are open.
You know, Grammy can't be in that line at the government clinic.
So, again, here's the reality. This is actually a call for us as Bahamians to ask, like I said, our representatives, how can we get better health care nationally? At the end of the day, should this really be on the public sector? We need to ensure that all of our government, make sure our hospital is up to standard. And so then in an instance like this, nobody can say, oh man, I can't go there. No, you should be able to go there. Why is this now on us as private businesses? Because at the end of the day, like I said, if we close, where will you go? You'll have no choice but to go to those same places.
You're saying in a statement temporary, but how long is that going to be? Is it just today? You're making a statement today. Are we going to for the rest of the week? What are we looking at?
We are making a statement for today. Our body has indicated that we are hopeful and very encouraged in hoping that Prime Minister Davis, would meet with us today. This morning, we could come to an agreement in which consultation will be within the pharmaceutical industry and the government on these amendments, but not just on the amendments, on ways that we can now bring about economic relief. Right. You know, at this current time, pharmacy is partnering with the government. So other than the reduction in these markups, we also took a reduction in the national prescription drug medication. So we are a public pharmacy still, per se. We provide the public medications for the government. We've been doing so for years now, you know, and we're now asking him to sit with us. If we've been partnering with you for all these years, we also partnered with the government for the COVID vaccination. You know, we were a part of that. We were the ones that helped to initiate, you know, the vaccination process. You know, pharmacists were there from day one. So in partnering, we want to speak with Prime Minister Davis and come up with a plan for economic relief.
All right, so we want to hear more about your recommendations when we get back. Dawn, I think, has some questions. We've got some text messages, a lot to get to, with Shantia McBride and Chargrega McPhee with the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. We're back after the news.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for your smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at Morning Blend 969 or facebook.com/morningblend969. Text us 422-4796. And now at 8:20, time for your another look at weather for today, brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance. Here is what's happening. We've got a few thunderstorms due to a slight uptick in mid-level moisture, but otherwise, high pressure will continue to dominate weather across the country. Meanwhile, sea swells from a low-pressure system just northeast of Bermuda will continue to create locally choppy seas as they impact Atlantic-exposed shorelines. For today, your forecast calls for partly sunny, very warm and locally breezy conditions with brief passing showers and a few short-lived thunderstorms, mainly offshore, becoming mostly fair and a bit warm and humid with most night. Expect downpours over portions of the extreme northwest and southeast Bahamas. Small craft caution in effect for all Atlantic-exposed shorelines due to swells, as well as all the islands in the southeast Bahamas, including Acklands, Crooked Island, Nagua, Meguana, and the adjacent Keys. Temperatures today getting up to around 90 Fahrenheit, 32 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down about 77 Fahrenheit, 25 Celsius. In your extended outlook, drier air moving across the country will gradually dampen significant weather chances as high pressure persists. Meanwhile, sea swells will temporarily subside, allowing for more favorable maritime conditions through Thursday. So for tomorrow, Wednesday, partly sunny to sunny, warm and breezy, with brief passing showers and the slight chance of isolated thunderstorms. Thursday, mostly sunny and warm with a few light showers. In the tropics, we've got Tropical Storm Lisa currently moving westwards across the central Atlantic. Elsewhere, a non-tropical area of low pressure a few hundred miles northeast of Bermuda has a low or 30% chance of tropical cyclone formation through the next 5 days as it moves slowly in an east-northeast direction. Back to Lisa. Lisa forecast to strengthen today. It is about 230 miles south-southeast of Grand Cayman. Lisa's moving forward. Along this general forecast, this motion, there's expected to be a decrease in forward speed over the next couple of days. On the forecast track, the center will pass south of the Cayman Islands today, then move near or over the Bay Islands of Honduras early Wednesday and approach Belize later Wednesday. Maximum sustained winds are near 45 miles per hour. Strengthening is again forecast today. Lisa could become a hurricane by early Wednesday over the northwestern Caribbean Sea. Lisa, no threat to the Bahamas, though. That's your Morning Blend weather check, brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance, still the first and only local insurance company and agency network that lets you buy car and home insurance 100% online. Try it at bahamasfirst.com. And we've got another check of traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC. For all of life's moments, there's one Visa Classic credit card. We're seeing some heavy traffic on Eastern Road from about Fox Hill up to Shirley Street. The work continues there on Shirley near the Village Road. It's single lane traffic there. So keep that in mind. It is causing some delays along Eastern Road. The heavy traffic, though, is on Milo Butler Highway, as usual, from Fire Trail all the way up to Tawny Gomes Darling Highway. Traffic backed up along Fire Trail as well. And that's the northbound lanes. Glaston Road also busy for you from Fire Trail up to JFK Drive. Elsewhere, just some pockets of locals in the area. And Blue Hill Road near St. Vincent Road and just north of Soldier on the way to Independence Drive. Those are your hot spots. That's your real-time traffic and your Morning Blend traffic alert, brought to you by RBC. Experience cashless purchasing power. And chip and pin security with your RBC Visa Classic credit card. Manage your day-to-day expenses and apply today at rbc.com/Caribbean/Visa Classic. We are back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn along with Don Sargent. We are talking with Shantia McBride and Chargrega McPhee with the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association. And we're getting a lot of these messages. People seem to be a 50-50 split on this, on whether what you all are doing is the right thing to shut down all of your locations today. Can you say how many of your members have decided to close their doors today?
Well, we have 80-plus pharmacies mm-hmm. throughout the Commonwealth. And at least from those that we have contacted and reached, at least 90%. But I would say, even in that 90%, no member was against it.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
So there were some members still in between as of wanting more information on it, because not everyone keeps up with everything, mm-hmm. you know.
Mm-hmm.
But 90% of our membership said, let's go, mm-hmm. go yeah. ahead. And BPA is here. I'm speaking for the industry. You know, and the association didn't say let's close. The members said it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm here to now enforce what the members said and to walk with them and show that the association stands behind them in their decision.
Okay, so we were having great conversations off air. We need to try to get as much of that on air as possible. We don't mm-hmm. have much time left. But this text here is a good way to get back into it. This person says here, the pharmacies are trying to strong arm the government. The government should hold their ground. I think this is just greed. Now, Sir Gregory, you were explaining how things work with some of the prices that you're seeing.
So there are two things that I want to speak to. One of them, and a lot of people have been talking about, especially a lot of older persons have been talking about the prescription drug plan
mm-hmm.
and how we're not substituting, we're not providing them with the medication. So what actually happens with the drug plan? Every pharmacy, because sometimes you may call, as you would have said with your story earlier.
Right.
You needed to get medication. You were asked, was this private stock or was this NIB?
Mm-hmm.
All pharmacies are required now to keep two separate stocks. So I'm just going to give a drug everybody's familiar with, like Codiavan. It is an expensive drug. So on the private side, as a pharmacy, I have to buy Codiavan for, let's say, about $60, and I have to sell it to you for about $80. Mm-hmm. There's only a $20 profit margin in there. Mm-hmm. Now, on the flip side with NIB drug plan, that same Codiavan, I'm getting that now for, I got to pay about $30 and probably only getting paid back $20-something on it.
Wow.
So you have an even smaller margin that I'm getting from that. So once that supply, and the governor's not giving us that medication, we still have to purchase it.
Mm-hmm.
We still got to purchase it and wait to be paid back. So when that is no longer available, we cannot substitute you the $60 one
mm-hmm.
and say, oh, government is going to, because government isn't going to pay me back $60
or
$10.
Well, of course, have you tried to ask him, could that work?
We were in negotiations mm-hmm. for the longest with the NIB drug plan, and this is one of the reasons why pharmacies are not a part of NHI. At the end of the day, healthcare is expensive. Somebody has to pay for it. And unfortunately, the government isn't able to pay for it, which is why there are so many pharmacies in the private sector being able to provide you with healthcare services, because the government cannot handle the burden and the load.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the drug plan. We work for you, they will shut me down because mm-hmm. now I've breached contract, because I can only use the NIB stock to provide you with. And the reality is, I mean, you know, you have aspirin. Something like aspirin is on the drug plan. Aspirin costs $3 private stock. But how many people, when aspirin isn't available on the drug plan, will refuse to buy it?
Mm-hmm.
We have it there. We are providing the medications. But then some persons just choose not to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's also the flip side of Bahamians. You know, we like brand things. I want all six versions of Theraflu. But Theraflu is now no longer available. So you know what some of us have to do? I have gone into Walmart before and I declare Walmart shelf.
Mm-hmm.
So the same Theraflu that you used to pay $8 for when you were buying it here locally, when we could have gotten it locally, I now have to go to Walmart. I have to pay $8 to buy it. And then I got to turn around and pay tax on it, pay tax on the shipping and duty for it. So by the time it comes here, I'm paying $16. I have to charge $16 because I already paid so much for it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're going to say, oh, y'all hike this up. Y'all do this. Y'all do that. Any of us now, a lot of us do online shipping. We buy something off of Amazon and it costs $5. By the time we bring it back from the shipping company, we pay in $25 and we're trying to figure out what in the world. It was about two or three sets of tax, plus the environmental levy, plus all these other things.
Yeah.
Pharmacy industry has the same problem. When we're bringing in all of these drugs that you need that are essential and life-saving, we have to pay the taxes. We have to pay the duties.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have to turn around and mark it up.
So, as in the...
Can you hear me, Dwight?
Yeah. Yes, Don,
well,
we can
well,
hear
two
you.
Things I wanted to chime in on. The part about the shipping thing, that is absolutely real. But I would assume, and you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, that in the case of pharmacies and most of the grocers in the country, you're purchasing most of your goods at wholesale prices versus what we have available to us at retail prices. Is that not the case?
So remember now, we're purchasing our stuff from manufacturers away. They don't give us any discount. They don't see
so
us as
So you're purchasing
big
at wholesale
pharma.
Prices, though.
So you're referring to the wholesalers?
No, I'm asking you because you're not going to. Well, I presume you're not going on Amazon or Walmart to purchase your drugs. You're purchasing those directly from the manufacturers.
So the wholesale companies.
Listen to her answer. Okay. Uh-huh.
The wholesale companies are purchasing from the manufacturers, but now what has to happen with them? They have to buy a certain quantity. They may have to buy 5,000 units. We don't have that much people in the Bahamas. So they're still taking a loss because in order to provide that medication for you, they're purchasing that. And then you have to think about expiry dates. Especially since COVID, we've had a lot of problems with drugs being expired. So now they're buying that 5,000 units.
I understand that, but I'm saying you're not purchasing this at a retail price.
Okay, so retailers, explain that.
So retailers now, we're not buying it at the price, but we still have to purchase it. Like I said to you, that same drug, that same example, I'm buying it for $60 and I'm selling it to you for $80. I can't even mark it up that much because then nobody is going to buy it. It's going to be too expensive.
No, I'm not suggesting that you shouldn't make profit. I'm just trying to make a stipulation so people understand that you're not.
So it's two different things here, right? So it's drugs and as a store, which you sell
the
store.
As a store, she mentioned Amazon and Walmart for a reason at this time. There are many pharmacies that have had to purchase from Amazon and Walmart lately. Since COVID, we're having sourcing issues with getting over-the-counter items, over-the-counter medication, as simple as NyQuil. I could say my pharmacy has purchased NyQuil from Amazon, and the NyQuil on Amazon is the same price that I would purchase it here. So now, at this time, after purchasing the NyQuil in bulk from Amazon, I need to now ship that here to have it on my shelf because my customer is going to ask me, as we say, some of us like brand. We want NyQuil. We want Theraflu. And if it's only available from those now online sources that we make a purchase from, we do that to service our customers to ensure that you have the medications that you are familiar with.
Right.
Because in our consultation with patients, we try to enlighten them that the medication ingredient is what matters, not the brand. But there are some patients that only want the brand. So therefore, we have sourced by Walmart, and we have sourced by Amazon. Or
it's due to supply issues from the manufacturing side. You guys have had to pay more by going through retailers. That's what I'm trying to understand.
Definitely,
here.
Yes. Because at the end of the day, we just try to look out for our customers. And like she explained, a lot of times, I mean, we really are asking our patients and our customers to understand where we're coming from and be here for us because we're always here for you during COVID. When at any point you could not get to your physician, you could not speak to your physician, where did you come? And we did our best under trying circumstances. And we wish to continue to keep doing that. But if at the end of the day, we cannot afford to stay open, then we can't help you. So for the persons who want to have our licenses revoked, or for the persons who were saying we greedy and we this and we that, when we get shut down at the end of the day, you're still going to have to go back to the government clinics.
Yeah. There's a text here saying, well, the grocers are saying they're keeping the doors open. They are in defiance of the order. Why didn't you all do that? I think you said earlier that you would be fine.
Yeah.
And this would
right.
Be-
we will mm-hmm. we will be fine. Mm-hmm. So now the grocers, at the end of the day, there's a certain amount of items. I think it's 38 categories, or there's a certain amount of items. So they still sell a lot of other things, and then they have a lot of their perishables. So it's a little more difficult for them to close their doors open after the government has already said, but they said we will be fined per item.
And this is almost everything you sell.
And that's almost everything. So or if you look at the categories, hypertensive drugs, cardiovascular drugs, diabetic drugs, all the drugs that people need, all the life-saving drugs are the ones that are at a challenge right now.
Wow. I'd like to add two things to this conversation, Dwight, if I may. Well, one thing was about, I think a comment was made earlier about the situation with healthcare and the quality of it and why we should demand better. I just wanted to throw in there that we actually did have this conversation several years ago about the expansion of NHI. And if I recall correctly, people complained about having to pay more taxes for it, and the insurance industry cried foul and said it would destroy them. So here we are. Second point on that. I also find that I'm understanding better the perspective of the farmers. I mean, pharmaceutical, the pharmacy, sorry, in New Providence. I'm better understanding their plight now. But the part that perplexes me about it is that, if I recall, when this current administration was in opposition, they decried the former minister's administration for coercing people through the means of fines and potential jail time for essentially violating the COVID-19 restrictions and curfews. But here we are doing the exact same thing to persons who are in the pharmaceutical industry. So, and it's on a per item basis, and just like how it was when we had the situation with parties, that if you had a party during COVID-19, you got fined in person. Mm-hmm. So we're using pretty much the same tactics to try to get the results that are desired by approach to the situation or the issue. But I have to ask then, is it the case that the government has mandated or is mandating that your prices for, let's say, for example, NyQuil has to be $15 to $16? Otherwise, you'll be fined? Or is it that they're restricting your margins?
They're restricting our margins. So within price control, wholesalers were at a rate of 25%. Mm-hmm. That has now been reduced to 15%. And retail, we were at 50%. We're now
down to 35.
Down to 35. Mm-hmm. So those are the margins that we were at and what now the government is mandating that we go down to.
Correct.
So at this time, the association is asking that we remain at the margins that we were at. We're not asking for any increases. We're not asking for any extra other than that. So at this current time, we're asking them to leave us where we're at.
And we actually even suggested a VAT holiday. And they said for this 3-month period, they want to provide some economic relief. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's take VAT off. Because remember, VAT just went on to prescriptions in January, you mm-hmm. know. All this time before, VAT was not on prescriptions. And a lot of patients didn't realize that. Mm-hmm. We all gone up on the price. No, our price is the same. There's now VAT on medications. And trust me, that has taken a substantial leap for a lot of customers. Because if you were now paying $80 for your drugs, you want a couple different drugs, now you're paying $100 and something. But that money is not coming to the pharmacy. That's what people have to understand. That money, we are collecting it for the government, and we have to pay it to the mm-hmm. government.
Yeah.
That is not our money.
All right, let's take this call really quickly. We're running out of time. Caller, good morning. Are you still there?
Yes, how are you doing, buddy?
We're doing well.
Yeah, man, I think we should, is dig deeper, okay? These small businesses, do not have the option the government has, okay? If the government is having a financial issue, they have the power to borrow money, okay? These businesses who are being adversely impacted do not have that option. Now, in January, in that lowering of the VAT, right? It actually increased prices across the board. Now, I think the government needs to be extremely careful as to how it goes about trying to do its business, because on the face of it, as if they're moving towards kind of socialism. Platform, and they're forcing people to, and they're forcing businesses to pay, these strange bills, I think we need to have these discussions mandated, because if businesses are to exist, right? And these are the same businesses that are gonna have to support the NHI. I think the government, and the Minister of Finance needs to be more sensible.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Let me just read this, and then we got to wrap things up. This person says, this is a tough one. The actions taken by your guests are viewed widely as extreme and callous. But with great respect, average Bahamians are ignorant to the logistics behind running a food and pharmaceutical operation, and this exercise will simply be seen as being done by greedy business people. As the old adage goes, be careful while challenging the government. On the other hand, there are many other ways to generate revenue by other means from that, from those that are benefiting more than others, many of whom are the ones addressed as honorable member. I think we kind of go over the same. All right, so what next? You're going to see what happens today. You're hoping to have a meeting with the prime minister or at least a minister of some kind.
We just want to be able to come to the table and come to an amicable arrangement on how can we help the public? How can we help the people? That's all we're asking for. Mm-hmm. This person is saying we blindsided them by doing this. We were blindsided when this whole thing hit us. You literally wake up one day and you're told you have to change all of your prices. You have to decrease your markups. So you're telling me I now have to do something that's going to put my business in a detriment, mm-hmm. possibly close my business. And we've been trying to wrap our minds around it. And I did hear a caller say, oh, but the government has to know. The government has to know. Do they really? Nobody came and asked us. We only wanted you to talk to us. Tell us what you need. We can tell you how we can help you to get there. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're looking for today. For them to bring us to the table and let's all figure out how to get there together.
Mm-hmm. And once again, mm-hmm. in asking us for that, I'd like to say that we're at the Prime Minister's office now asking for
yes.
an audience.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So there are people out there now?
Yes. Mm-hmm. We have owners out there.
We're there now. Mm-hmm. And we're asking for an audience. I will be heading there now. Mm-hmm. We will both be in there now.
So that but we can have asking, a meeting. Yes. We really would just like to be able to talk and come to some amicable arrangement.
Yeah. This is a tricky one. This is a really tricky one. Everybody, we can understand both sides. We're hoping for the best resolution for everybody. Shantia McBride and Chagrega McPhee, thank you for being here. Hopefully the next time we talk... things will be in a more in a better place.
We'll be to work.
Yeah, right, exactly.
I know that.
Thank you very much. Hopefully, it's only for today. Yes. Hopefully. But keep us posted, definitely. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks for having
Have a great one.
We're going to take a break and be back with more Morning Blend on Guardian Radio. Stay with us.
Wendy's. Introducing the Breakfast Biggie Bag. Enjoy a double sausage muffin with two square sausage patties, a freshly cracked egg, and cheese served on a toasted English muffin, a medium waffle fries, and an orange juice for only $5.25, fat inclusive. Add an apple pie for just $1 more.
Say what?
Hey. Offers valid in participating locations. Wendy's, different inside and out.
I used to think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem. Just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
Join Journey Rewards for free, and every purchase is another chance to win big monthly prizes, like a cruise for two, plane tickets, free fuel, and so much more. Just scan, win, repeat. Fuel up or grab a snack or a drink at any Esso service station. Then scan the QR code to enter your purchase information. That's it. The more you enter, the more you can win. And win, and win again. Journey Rewards. Scan, win, repeat. Free to join and easy to enter. Stop by an Esso service station and start winning today. The Esso brand is a trademark of ExxonMobil.
Know how important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options. We're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Street, has those hard-to-find fasteners for you right now. You can find stainless steel regular hex, carriage bolts, galvanized bolts, threaded rods, nails, self-tap screws, sex bolts, anchor bolts, turnbuckles, masonry tools, hand tools, and weed whacker strings. Check out the rope selection and car body fasteners, too. Special orders are welcome. It's your number one fastener store. Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Streets. Call 326.
You were exposed to COVID-19, have symptoms, or traveled recently, get tested so that you can have peace of mind about your status. Just visit one of our convenient locations on New Providence at the University of the Bahamas or Golden Gates Plaza, weekdays 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Saturdays 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. On Eleuthera at the Three Island Dock, Mondays through Thursdays, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., Fridays and Saturdays, 8 a.m. to 7 p.m., and Sundays, 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. On Exuma at the Regatta Park, weekdays, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m., Saturdays, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m., and Sundays, 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. On Abaco at Maxwell Food Store, Mondays through Saturdays, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. The COVID-19 test results will be ready in 15 minutes, and the tests are free.
This message is brought to you by PAHO WHO and the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
When one says Rust-Oleum, one thinks Bahamian paint. Bahamian paint carries over 150 different Rust-Oleum spray products. I'm talking products like Rust-Oleum's textured finishes, you know, the leather effect, the antique look, or the hammered finish. Now we're talking about Rust-Oleum's tub and tile paint, chalkboard paint, and the dry erase board and a can paint. The inverted spray is used to mark sports fields, parking spaces, or foundations. And of course, the granddaddy of Rust-Oleum's rust-fighting family, Rust-Oleum's 9100 heavy-duty anti-corrosion coating that gives metal unmatched protection against the elements. That's why when one says Rust-Oleum, one thinks of Bahamian paint. Harold Road and Mackey Street. Right now, get 20% off all cash sales through December 24th.
This is 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I used to bite my tongue and hold my breath, scared to rock the boat and make a mess. So I said quietly, agreed politely. I guess that I forgot I had a choice. I let you push me past the breaking point. I stood for nothing, so I fell for everything. You held me down, but I got up, already brushing off the dust. You hear my voice, you hear that.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strong along with Don Sargent. All right, hey, that was the hot topic for the day. We're going to leave that there and keep you posted. Stay tuned to the Guardian News Network for the very latest on what's happening with the BPA, the Bahamas Pharmaceutical Association. As you heard, they are trying to meet the Prime Minister today, and we will definitely keep you posted on that. All right, so moving on, we're talking about your health today. For women who have been told they need to have a hysterectomy, what are your options, especially afterward? We're going to talk about that this morning. We're very pleased to have with us in studio Dr. Laura DeRosier and Dr. Dorita Francis Phillips. Ladies, great to have you with us. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having us.
And you are with Doctors Hospital, is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah. Okay. So let's get some definitions. Some folks who might not know, especially men, hysterectomy, what exactly that is and why one might need to have one. One of the common reasons why women need to have hysterectomies.
Okay. So
Good morning. Thanks for having me here. Let's start off by just saying what a hysterectomy is, yep. Okay? So basically, a hysterectomy can be just the removal of the uterus, which is commonly called the womb. It can also be involving removal of both the uterus and the cervix, which is the lower aspect of the uterus itself. It may also involve moving the fallopian tubes and the ovaries as well. So commonly, women may have a hysterectomy for various, but the five common indications for a hysterectomy may include things like abnormal uterine bleeding. So the patient is having very heavy bleeding or prolonged and heavy bleeding. So anything that's changed in the pattern of their normal menstruation. Commonly in the Bahamas, women tend to have hysterectomies for symptomatic fibroids, uterine fibroids. So I'm sure that we've quite commonly talk about fibroids. There can be other reasons. They can be reasons like chronic pelvic pain, which may be due to things like endometriosis. So those are some. You may also have to have a hysterectomy for conditions such as pre-malignant diseases, like early pre-malignant changes involving the uterus and or the cervix. And also, it may be done along with adjuvant surgeries or other surgery in conjunction for women who have pelvic organ prolapse.
Right. So how common is it here? What are we looking at these days? And has that changed over the years?
It's actually quite a common procedure, particularly for gynecologists. We do it every day. It's a very common procedure. It's probably more women are doing it, maybe for other reasons, maybe even a little earlier age, but it's actually one of the most common gynecological procedures.
Yeah. Boy. All right. So, fibroids, as you said, is a big issue here. So many women. Okay, so you've been told that you need to have one. That's the topic today. What next? Is it not just, okay, well, it's done, now that's it? Or are there other things you need to be thinking about, considering?
Okay, so I think basically we would like to start by informing the patient what the hysterectomy is and the reason. So the rationale for the hysterectomy is very important. So especially when the woman is considering what the expectations may be after the hysterectomy. But the important thing is, one, evaluating the patient and helping the patient to guide them as to what type of hysterectomy is actually appropriate for them, as there are several types of hysterectomies. So basically, we can do a hysterectomy via different routes, where you can do it traditionally, or as we call it, the conventional hysterectomy, which is done with an abdominal incision. So you access the surgery basically through an abdominal incision, and that can be done a total hysterectomy that way, or a supracervical, which is just involving removal of the uterine body but remaining the cervix, or total hysterectomy where both uterus and the cervix is removed. These modalities can also be done vaginally. So the hysterectomy, instead of having an incision on the abdomen, is actually approached through the vagina. And also, of course, minimally invasive surgery is now in some areas and mostly the preferred method. And so that's basically involving a laparoscopic hysterectomy. So all those different types of hysterectomies can actually be done laparoscopically, or it can actually be done using robotic-assisted hysterectomies. So those are the different types. So once a patient basically understands that it's not just one form of hysterectomy and one size does not fit all, I think that's important to establish early in the game. And so the physician's role is basically to identify or to inform the patient of these different routes and help them to choose, or help guide them as to what is actually best for them.
All right. So are certain ones better for certain people, or does it depend on the condition that you have? How does it work exactly? Dr. Lohr?
Yeah, I can't emphasize enough what Dr. Frantz assured, that we are evaluating the patient and looking to see what particular patient, because there is not a one-size-fits-all type of picture when we're looking at making the decision of what route is appropriate for a hysterectomy. Certainly, we like to emphasize a minimally invasive route. We think that not only that we think it's better, but there's plenty of data that demonstrates that recovery is better for patients. There's less blood loss. Time to return to work is decreased. So a minimally invasive route is certainly should be explored when a patient is coming in. But we have to look at certain things. We have to look at what are their comorbidities. A patient is coming in. If they're severely obese, then we have to look at that as well. We also have to look at, is there hypertension and diabetes? Are there any cardiomyopathies, cardiac issues that may determine what's the best way to position the patient at the time of the procedure? So looking at the patient holistically is very important. The reality is that for the majority of patients that are coming in for a hysterectomy, we can usually approach it from a minimally invasive route, either a vaginal hysterectomy or a laparoscopic approach. And when we say laparoscopy, we don't just mean, you know, straight stick laparoscopy or the keyhole. We mean, you know, laparoscopy can be both the traditional laparoscopic as well as...
Yeah, so with diabetes and high blood pressure being so common here, that would work for most women. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. In fact, it's better for them.
Yeah.
Certainly, you know, for patients who are diabetic and they typically have a higher BMI, there's a risk of an infection at the time of surgery, especially if you have a fan and still incision, which is that little, we like to call it the mini cut or the, you know, C-section cut. It's a small cut that's transverse that goes on the lower aspect of the abdomen. But if you've got somebody who's got a large penis, meaning a large abdomen, that's certain with a lot of adipose tissue, that increases the risk of a seroma, which is just a little bit of a fluid collection. And that certainly can get infected. So the laparoscopic procedures, you're less likely to have the risk of infection at the incision site.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned recovery time. So let's compare the various procedures and the time generally it takes to recover from each one of them.
Right. So I think I'll start. Uh-huh. So typically with your conventional, so let's start with let's start with the conventional and move our way up to minimally invasive. Mm-hmm. So the conventional, usually we tell patients recovery can be anywhere from 6 to 8 weeks. Yeah, so depending on other things may basically interfere or are factors that may change that recovery in terms of the person's health. Like Dr. Laura mentioned, their penis, whether there's infection. But generally speaking, for conventional, it can take upwards of 6 to 8 weeks.
Pretty long time.
Yeah, so that's 6 to 8 weeks of time loss from work, 6 to 8 weeks of basically recovering at home and needing some sort of assistance.
Now, like, were you going to be in bed for most of that time?
Well, no, we don't want you to be in bed for the whole 6 to 8 weeks. Uh-huh. So basically, the amount of what you can do will actually increase as the time goes by. So, of course, initially at home, you will be not confined to bed, but you won't be able to do a lot of, like, regular housework, driving, etc. Those sorts of things you basically won't be able to do in the immediate postoperative period. Mm-hmm. When you think about things like vaginal hysterectomy, the recovery may be shorter. So we're thinking of about maybe cutting down to about 4 weeks. In terms of minimally invasive, the recovery is less. So your recovery time can be somewhere about 3 to 4 weeks. Some persons are more able to be up and about by about 2 weeks. And so definitely the return to your pre-surgical state is much, much easier mm-hmm. with minimally invasive surgery.
Mm-hmm. And what about other physiological changes and psychological changes as well? What do people need to know or keep in mind?
I think one of the physiological and important thing basically for recovery from surgery or an entity is the postoperative pain and the pain that you may experience even as you are recovering over those weeks after the surgery. And definitely it is much, much easier with a minimally invasive procedure. It's actually sometimes the requirements for pain medications, not sometimes, but the requirement for your pain medication is far less with a minimally invasive procedure compared to one that's an open procedure. So that actually, if a female is in less pain, then clearly she's actually able to get up and do a little bit more, feel a little bit more like herself, do a little bit more for the family. And so that's important now. If you're basically stuck with a whole lot of pain experiences, then that actually is going to dampen your whole well-being. So I think that is one of the first things that I would say. Mm-hmm. Laura, do you want to add?
So, you know, what, as soon as you said, like, the psychological component of it, your history of psychology, right, your psychology background probably is thinking about the word hysterectomy and hysteria, right? The
Slightly.
Two being...
That's funny.
The two of them being linked together. So I want to say that that's been fully debunked. Mm. I used to say that if you have a hysterectomy, that can lead to hysteria.
Oh,
I mean, that's where the two terms come from. That's the link. That's been debunked quite a while. So, you know, women do not have to be afraid that if they have a hysterectomy, it's going to make them crazy or anything. But I do think we have to be aware that, you know, that there are certain physiologic changes that happen as a result of whether or not there is the ovaries are removed.
Right.
And I think
right.
to Dr. Frances Phillips' point, that needs to be discussed. And it's a discussion that needs to happen before. So that you can sort of transition, because I really think it's setting the expectation for the patient, right? So that they know sort of ahead of time as much as possible, you know, what are reasonable expectations? So having a discussion of, you know, whether or not we need to take the ovaries out will be appropriate. Are there any adnexal cysts or, you know, things that we're concerned, issues that we're concerned? Is there an underlying history of BRCA? Especially important here because there's such a strong family history of breast and ovarian cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So do we need to have this genetic evaluation beforehand?
Mm-hmm.
That's sometimes we're going to be with patients, right? So patients who are BRCA positive, particularly BRCA 1 and 2, your ovarian cancer rate is upwards of 20 to 30%. So in those instances, we really want to have that conversation beforehand. So it's important for patients, you know, who are looking around and saying, oh, you know what, I have a lot of people in my family that have had either breast, ovarian, or colon cancer. Well, maybe it makes sense for me to have a conversation with my physician about, is genetic testing appropriate, especially since I'm going to have this procedure anyway.
Right. We're getting a question. So does that automatically mean that you are going to be in menopause if you have a hysterectomy? And will there be other issues like that?
Okay, so that's a very good question. So, of course, like Dr. Laura mentioned, if you had a hysterectomy, one that is just involving the uterus and the cervix, then your ovaries have not been removed, then you will not go naturally into, you won't go into what we call surgical menopause.
Mm-hmm.
If you are a candidate that had both ovaries removed, then of course you tend to go into surgical menopause. Now, however, let me hasten and say that also for people with hysterectomy where there was conservation of the ovaries, what we have found is that these patients tend to go into menopause perhaps a little earlier than someone who was of the same age set but had not had a hysterectomy. And that is because sometimes during the surgery, there may be a little bit of disturbance to the blood supply to the ovaries. And so sometimes that can basically start the process of declining in the estrogen supplies. Now, in terms of someone who has basically had a total hysterectomy, or as we say in the Bahamas, a complete hysterectomy, where you've removed the uterus, cervix, and ovaries, then we can anticipate symptoms of menopause that can start sometimes within a few months after the surgery. Those the menopause symptoms for those patients may be more acute than for a person of like age that may have gone through the natural process of menopause, because basically in a natural process, the hormones will decline, you know, at a slower rate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And how common is it for the ovaries to not be taken out when you do the hysterectomy? And what would be the reasons you would not do that?
I mean, so the data is pretty clear. It used to be that, you know, we'd say, oh, we're going to take the ovaries just in case, right?
Mm-hmm.
The data is pretty clear that the ovaries actually are, even when you're postmenopausal, the ovaries are producing utter supportive to your brain and your eyes and your, you know, your bones. So we actually don't recommend, unless there's a strong family history or a genetic abnormality, in which case it would make sense to remove the ovaries. We do not recommend removing the ovaries prior to the age of 61, 62. There's actually a really large randomized trial that's been out for about 20-ish years now that really demonstrated that there is an increased risk of premature removal of the ovaries in patients who are both pre- and postmenopausal. Mm-hmm. So unless there is, you know, I'll have this conversation, and I'm sure Dr. Francis Phillips has this conversation as well, with the patients prior to a hysterectomy, unless there's a strong family history or genetic abnormality or a reason, an adnexal mass, meaning a cyst or some reason why we need to take the ovary out, mm-hmm. overwhelmingly, we do not remove the ovaries. Having said that, there's also really good data that demonstrates that removing the fallopian tubes is really essential and decreases the risk of an epithelial ovarian cancer, okay. upwards of 93%. Mm-hmm. And so at the time of a hysterectomy, irrespective whether you're pre- or postmenopausal, it's recommended that the fallopian tubes should be removed because of that risk reduction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wow. Okay. Are the numbers about what we're seeing, how many... I know you say it's a very frequent surgery, but percentage-wise, or is there anything you say almost daily there's this type of surgery here, but what are we looking at? Do we have any ideas?
You mean the amount of hysterectomies yeah. that we actually perform mm-hmm. per day? Well, I would say it depends on the practice. It depends basically on the person's practice. You can see it's not uncommon to have at least a surgeon doing at least two hysterectomies a day, or two hysterectomies per operative day, which is basically maybe one operative day per week. So it's that common. Wow. Yeah. So for some that are busier than others, I'm certain that you do a hysterectomy almost weekly.
My goodness. Okay.
Yeah. Wow. So it's a pretty common procedure.
All right. So what else would you say to a woman who's being told that, yeah, this is the direction we have to go? What are other things that they need to keep in mind that you need to be aware of and think about for your future?
So I think one of the important places to start is making sure that the person is fit for the surgery mm-hmm. and having certain investigations performed prior to the surgery. So like Dr. Lauren mentioned, if the patient have other comorbid conditions like diabetes and hypertension, those conditions are well controlled. Anything that can basically affect the patients basically during the surgery and immediately after. If it's a patient who have renal disease or cardiovascular disease, that we may have to involve a multiple disciplinary approach, making sure that they are seen by their regular physicians and those things are optimized prior to surgery, just so that we can have the best outcome holistically for the patient.
Yeah. Wow. All right. And what else? What else would you say, Dr. Laura, advice that you give to women out there?
So I'm a urogynecologist, so I think it's really important that we have a full discussion of other symptoms that may be happening at the time, right? So really taking the time to either ask the patient or for the patient to bring up the fact that, you know, oh, by the way, I'm actually noticing that I'm having more urinary urgency, more frequency. I'm leaking when I cough, or if I pick up, you know, like I'm, you know, running around with my grandchild and I pick them up and all of a sudden I'm having a little bit of leakage. I think those need to be discussed. I think also, you know, an evaluation of, is there anything that's dropping in the vagina? Prolapse is very common. We know that upwards of 50% lifetime risk of having prolapse, that's a whole lot of people who will have some degree of prolapse. Having said that, only want to need surgical intervention. But I do think it's really important to discuss that prior to, you know, unfortunately, the risk of not addressing it before surgery is that it will, you know, thinking that it's going to go away by itself. A hysterectomy does not treat prolapse. I cannot emphasize that enough. So if you're having dropping of the vagina, a bulge symptom, if you feel like, you know, I took a mirror, I looked, and there was this, you know, a little bit of pink tissue right there, that is prolapse. Prolapse is a hernia, and the way that we fix hernias is surgically. Now, if you're going to have surgery, it makes sense to go ahead and evaluate to see what are the ways that we can optimize this prolapse at the same time. These procedures can be done concomitantly with your OBGYN performing the hysterectomy portion and then a urogynecologist or a trained urologist. So urogynecology is now sort of an older term for our field. It's FPMRS, which is female pelvic medicine and reconstructive surgery. Typically, it's a fellowship trained physician who's done either OBGYN or urology and then have done additional 3 years respectively. So 3 years for an OBGYN, 2 years for a urologist, for a total of 7 years. So anyway, at any rate, they would be well qualified. Any FPMRS would be qualified to take care of any apical prolapse, meaning the top of the vagina is dropping, any cystocele or rectocele, that's when the anterior wall of the vagina starts to fall, or rectocele, which is when the posterior walls of the vagina start to fall.
Yep. Wow. All right. We're talking with Dr. Laura DeRosier and Dr. Dorita Francis Phillips. If you have any questions, text us 422-4796 or call in 323-6232, 325-4316. 325-4259. All right, so what can be done before we get to this point? Is there some health tips that you have for women that so that we can avoid going down this route of hysterectomy? Is that possible at all?
So there are basically alternatives to hysterectomy. Hysterectomy would basically be more, as we call it, a definitive management. So it all depends on what the patient's conditions might be or what indications they may have had that can eventually or lead to a hysterectomy. So say, for instance, if a patient is experiencing heavy menstrual bleeding, the cycles have been coming prolonged and they're heavy and they're soaking excessive amount of pads, a lot of women will just basically sit and ignore that situation until basically it affects their overall health. So each month there's a blood loss until the point where they become excessively anemic, and now it's difficult to carry out simple chores as walking or climbing stairs or even basically sitting up at work. So basically those patients may not necessarily need a hysterectomy depending on the cause. There can be other forms of treatment. We can use sometimes various birth control tablets that are manufactured to decrease the amount of blood loss. There are also other modalities that we can do in terms of even the placement of an intrauterine device, which is a hormonal device, the Mirena we know it as, which actually is quite good in decreasing the blood loss. So significantly over 50% of their bleeding per month. So that's one thing. Sometimes patients who may actually encounter hysterectomy may even be patients with endometriosis, which is a very chronic debilitating disease. They tend to suffer from a lot of pelvic pain, pain excessively during the menstruation. They may also have excessive pain during intercourse. And so these patients sometimes at their wit's end may eventually with a hysterectomy, but they can also be managed with some of these same modalities. Usually first step treatments can be contraceptive relief along with pain medications, the use of progestogens, especially the intrauterine devices. Dr. Laura's area, I'm sure that she will expand on, of patients with pelvic organ prolapse who may actually not be candidates for surgery. So that's also another entity of patients who may not be fit. We're talking about patients with severe comorbid conditions, patients with very bad cardiovascular disease. We're talking about patients even with severe renal impairments. These may not be, or even your extreme elderly patients. So you may be able to use more conservative treatment approaches for these patients in terms of inserting pessaries, and that actually can help these patients to get some relief and avoid surgery. Mm-hmm. So those are some of the modalities that we can actually utilize. So in terms of our common conditions here that patients experience with uterine fibroids, there are things that we can actually do. You don't necessarily have to have a hysterectomy for uterine fibroids. There are other modalities. There are things like uterine artery embolization, which may actually help to decrease the blood flow and increase the growth of the fibroids before it gets to a certain stage where it has to be removed. Also, likewise, a patient may not have to have a hysterectomy for management of uterine fibroids, and so I want to be clear, particularly in our younger patients who still have a very active reproductive career. They're still thinking about their fertility, even though they may qualify for a surgical procedure, and in some cases may need a surgical procedure. But we also offer them what we call a myomectomy, which is just simply the removal of the uterine fibroids, but preserving their fertility. Yeah, yeah, so we preserve the uterus for those, the younger persons.
Yeah. I'm just thinking, we don't talk about this enough, do we? It just, in all the, we've been on this on the air for 10 years. I don't think maybe once we've had a similar conversation.
I mean, we talk about
so many other medical issues.
True.
But this affects so many people.
Yeah. I totally agree with you. I think that, you know, we're hoping to get the conversation started, mm-hmm. right? Because, you know, I think that we're becoming more comfortable as a society to discuss our taking our own healthcare into our own hands, realizing that it's not just the doctor's responsibility, that we, you know, it's we can also ask the questions in a very respectful way. And I think physicians are, you know, wanting patients to be engaged. And so and I know that I get excited when I get a patient that's engaged in what's going on and wanna, you know, have a discussion. So we want to start a discussion around what the options are, and then also letting patients know that there is information that they can gain by starting a conversation either with their primary care or their OBGYN. And then it's okay to say, listen, can a place where I can have additional information about this? I wanted to emphasize for pelvic pain, because there are, you know, I think it, pelvic pain because of endometriosis and a variety of different reasons. We see it particularly, I think, within communities of color. And there is a sense that, you know, a hysterectomy is going to fix the pelvic pain issue. Mm-hmm. And I really want us to have it. We probably need to come back and have a specific discussion about pelvic pain. because the data shows that a hysterectomy will only improve pain issues 50% of the time.
Oh, boy.
And so it's really important that we have that discussion before, not only to set expectations for patients, but also to see what other modalities can we do, can we incorporate in our care process. And, you know, and building our Urogyn Center, we're really looking forward to having a multidisciplinary approach, working with Dr. Francis Phillips and working with the nutritionist, working with behavioral therapists, working with pelvic floor therapists. I think that's really important that we're looking at other modalities that can help patients as they navigate these processes, which can be very disconcerting, right? Because that's a very intimate part of your, it affects your relationship, it affects your, how you function, you know, your job, it affects, see yourself as a woman.
Right.
And I really would like to, you know, have that conversation as well.
Yeah, that's part of the psychological stuff we were talking about earlier as well.
Right.
I've got a couple of calls here, or you want to?
No, I was going to say that just bear in mind with our culture, it's not that sometimes we find it a little bit more difficult to open up to what you're experiencing. And if the patients do take the time to open up, you would realize that you're not the only person that's experiencing it. And as women in the Bahamas, what we tend to do, too, is we put all the focus on the family. We put all the focus on, you know, our work, and then we basically leave ourselves to the end. So we just basically grin and bear until it basically explodes and we can't take it anymore. So if women are actually seeing their primary care physicians and or their gynecologists regularly for their annual physical examinations, these are some of the things that can be discussed. And sometimes you can basically save yourself from even going to the last stage of a surgical procedure. You may actually be able to intervene. We may be able to intervene much earlier with them.
Absolutely. Caller, you're on Morning Blend. Good morning. Are you there? Hi, caller. I hear something. Okay. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hi, yes. Good morning.
Hi, Dwight. This is LeVette from North Carolina calling in.
Hi. Good morning.
Yeah, so it's very timely information from the two doctors who are in studios, Blige Harris, all the time talking about this. I was a surgical nurse for almost 30 years, med surgical nurse for 30 years. And I always tell patients who do go on the surgery on having a hysterectomy, the main thing is the education before, like the doctors were saying in the studio. I think a lot of times patients may be hesitant to ask those questions, and they just be like, okay, yeah, that's what the doctor says, oh, that's what the nurse says, you know. But having that discussion and also education pre surgery wise, especially when they actually get into the hospital, and following directions of the nurse and the doctor, which is very important. I think a lot of times people, oh, I know what I'm doing. Oh, I know this, I know that. I mean, I can say a few stories, but I wouldn't say it here on the radio. Mm. But I think, especially with the pain management and ambulation after the surgery, I know a lot of times, you know, person say, oh, you're so cruel, you're trying to get me up early, I just had surgery. Yes, it's best for you to get up out of that bed right the same morning as after the surgery and start ambulating. Go to the chair, sit back in the bed, go back like 2 hours afterwards, sit. And I know the doctors would say that ambulation is the best, along with the pain management, at least in the first 24 hours. And when I say drugs, I mean the medication, pain medication. I think a lot of times patients also wait until they get the pain. No, don't do that. Mm. If the doctors say you're getting Pethidine or whatever medication they put you on every 6 hours to 8 hours, get it on time, because when that pain comes, it's harder for you to get rid of that pain, and it's harder for you to do ambulation. So the ambulation is fast. The pain management, get that out of the way. Mm-hmm. Avoiding infection of the wound care. That's another very important, very, very important issue when it comes to care and all of that.
Yep.
But I just want to say I love MedSurgical, especially surgical, especially counseling and educating patients pre and post surgery and any surgery. And I know you're talking about hysterectomy. But any surgery, I love that pre and post part of it. So please, persons, ask questions all the time from your doctors, from your nurses. Mm-hmm. You know, ask questions, questions, questions. And like the doctor said, how about this question? Thank you so much.
Levette, thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you very much. Appreciate the call. This texter says, I had a hysterectomy 7 years ago due to fibroids. I was not given other options by my physician. Just wanted to help my fault. As I was not fully educated. Oh, boy. I'm sure you see these stories.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think if I can, to piggyback on with the caller, some of the things that the caller mentioned, mm-hmm. I think one of the things that I advise patients, if you're coming in for your preoperative evaluation, meaning that whereas the physicians, we're going to be sitting down talking to you about what to expect at the time of surgery, it's important to sometimes think about things that may concern you or may be specific to you. Write them down. Have a list. Come with a friend. Come with your husband. Come with your sister. Just come with someone, because sometimes when you get there in the chair and you actually forget the things that were most important, and so you may not get all of your answers that same time. But it's also important in terms of the physician to basically outline. We do it every day. We see patients postoperatively all the time, and so there are certain simple things that we take for granted that we assume that, okay, it's like firsthand to us, but the patient has no knowledge. So I find it's always the patients have a better experience going through the whole process when you basically engage them. Every detail that they're going to go through, from the recovery room back to their admission ward room where they're going to be, how we deal with the pain medication, if we have to use other modalities like drains, what they're going to be for, when to expect them, when to expect the nurse to remove them, what to expect when you go home. So it's important. And what she mentioned about the pain medication is very, very important, because that is very common. Patients all the time wait until the pain really, really gets at its climax,
yeah,
and then they resort to the pain medication.
Right. Getting this text here, is there a difference with sex after hysterectomy for the woman and her partners?
Which one of us want to take that one? We were just talking about that. So so basically...
It's a deep breath there.
Yeah, I have to take a deep breath. I have to take a deep breath. Okay, so basically what studies have found is, honestly, in general, what your sex life was before. If you had a good sex life prior to surgery, you tend to have a good sex life after surgery. Now, having said that, there can be more improvements in your sexual life after surgery compared to your sex life before. And that depends on the indication for the surgery. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, if a woman is having a surgery because she had some amount of pelvic pain, she had a large uterus, and she was bleeding all the time, then, of course, these things hindered your sex life. Or if you were always basically the fact that, hey, you're going to have some spotting, you're going to have some bleeding, then with that being removed now, right, it's psychologically better and actually physically better because you've removed the issue that basically inhibited the sexual performance. Now, in terms of the flip side of that, it's not been found that having a hysterectomy actually would worsen your sex life. Mm-hmm. So basically, generally, would have a pretty much a good sex life. Now, there are things about whether or not the ovaries were removed and issues with respect to a patient that may be encountering menopause symptoms. Now, that might be an entity on its own, whether or not the patient may have some, you know, vaginal dryness. And so that in itself may cause some issues. And those are things, too, to direct with your gynecologist. You know, you're having some difficulty. It's a little bit more painful now because it's a little bit drier. And you don't have to suffer through that. Mm-hmm. There are things that we can give you that actually can assist that so that you do not have to have a worse sexual experience.
Right. Wow. All right, we're getting a lot of questions about fibroids, so I think we might need to have you all back and talk about that at some point.
All right, yeah, I love that.
But so some final words, our final couple of minutes here, to women who are listening to this, who are or who know that they are going to have to consider this or have been told that they need to, what would you say to them?
Dr.
Laura?
So, you know, I think that start the conversation, right? So you've been told that you need to have a hysterectomy. Ask the questions that are appropriate. Make sure that, and you know, and I think part of the issue is sometimes you don't know what questions to ask. But there are lots of websites that I think are very helpful. So, you know, there are websites at www.augs.org. It's our urogynecology website that sort of delineates, you know, lots of questions, you know, so you need to have surgery or you're having symptoms of this. And these are the questions that you should ask. So those are good websites. I actually love this website. And I know other physicians may cringe when I say this, but Hyster Sister, it's a website that is all it's, you know, and sort of an open forum where women who've had hysterectomies go on and they will describe their process. They talk about, you know, what their expectations were, what their process was. They have lots of helpful like pre and post suggestions, things that can be very helpful. For example, you know, my patient was, I love to discuss constipation because constipation is a really big issue oftentimes after surgery. And so we have a full discussion about it. And I like to promote this thing called a squatty potty. I don't have stock in them, but it's just essentially it's a stool that you can put your feet on. It just helps to elevate your pelvis such that it makes bowel movements so much easier. Mm-hmm. And my patient literally was like laughing out of the door. She was like, "Oh my God, you're so funny," you know. And then she went on Hyster Sister and she saw all the comments about it and she got it. And she was like, "That's what influenced me. That's what helped me to make the decision about it." So anyway,
how do you spell
I think
H-Y-S-T-E-R Sister.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So those are great websites that I think are helpful. Obviously, you know, Google should not be your medical doctor, but I think also just looking up online and seeing, I think we are not opposed to patients coming in and saying, you know, I read about this. What do you think about that? And opening up the conversation. I think if nothing else, what we'd like to sort of solidify is the fact that we really want to, you know, it's standard of care that when we're having a hysterectomy that, you know, we're going to go to the minimally invasive route. And we really want to support that and you know, push that. We really want to allow women to have that conversation. And when, you know, potentially, you know, the question is, can I have it minimally invasive or not? If there is a need for a second opinion, we highly recommend it. We think it's not a bad idea to have the conversations beforehand. And at Doctors Hospital, we're here to support that.
Mm-hmm. All right. Dr. Dorita Francis Phillips, your final word.
Yeah, I basically concur with everything that Dr. Laura also a good thing to speak to. One of the things that we lack in the Bahamas is like the supports, the support groups. So, you know, you're not going to have a group of women who saying that, oh, you know, I had a hysterectomy, let me form a post-hysterectomy group. But sometimes they're women in your church, they're women in your workplace, and you can speak to them to get experiences firsthand. So particularly related to here in this side of the world, you know. So I support that as well. But I really, really, really want to emphasize to patients, there's no need to suffer. There's no need to suffer with prolonged and heavy bleeding. And a lot of patients think it's normal to use the large size pads and to use two and three at a time and to double them up with also tampons. You don't have to suffer through this. You can speak with your gynecologist and we can fix it, whether it's medically correcting the issues or surgically. And so like Dr. Laura said, we are here to help. We're here to guide you with the best form of the best modality for you for your care.
Yeah. Good stuff. Why can't someone form a group like that? Someone should do
it's
it,
a
right?
Great
yeah.
idea. There you go. There you go.
Right.
It's such a great idea.
Yeah.
Hysterectomy Bahamas version.
There you go. Dr. Laura DeRosier and Dr. Dorita Francis Phillips, who said this is your first time on radio. Dr. Laura clearly has done this many times.
You
did a wonderful job.
Great job.
That was
thank
wonderful.
You.
Great. Both of you. Thank you so much for being here this morning. And we can get more information at Doctors Hospital. Is that right?
Yes.
That's correct.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you all. Appreciate it. We're going to take a break and be back with Morning Glen Business here on Guardian Radio 96.9.
I used to bite my tongue and hold my breath, scared to rock the boat and make a mess. So I said quietly, agreed politely. I guess that I forgot I had a choice. I let you push me.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas. This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Wake up today. Wake up. It's a new day.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Blend Business on this Tuesday, November 1st, 2022. Welcome back to our Morning Blend listeners. Once again, I am Dwight Strawn, and this morning we are going to be talking about the Caribbean Investment Forum. The Caribbean Export Development Agency will be hosting the inaugural Caribbean Investment Forum in just a few days. Here to tell us all about this, is that how you pronounce it, Leo? I hope.
Thank you, Dwight. Yeah, it's Leo Nout, but
Nout.
It's fine.
Okay.
I get called Nout all the time.
Oh, boy. Well, I'm going to call you Leo Nout. All right, great to have you with us, sir. All right, so for those who might not be familiar, tell us about the Caribbean Export Development Agency, and then we'll talk about the forum. A lot of great stuff coming out of the forum. But tell us about the agency first.
Well, thank you very much, Dwight, for this opportunity. We really are excited to talk to you a little bit more about the Caribbean Investment Forum that we're hosting in Trinidad from the 8th to the 11th of this year in November in Port of Spain. Caribbean Export is the only regional trade and investment promotion agency in all of the African, Caribbean, and Pacific states group. That is a compilation of countries that come together that we share commonalities in terms of development goals and challenges ahead. So we are the only regional trade and investment promotion agency. And what that means is that we're focused on accelerating the economic transformation of the Caribbean and work with private sector to increase exports, attract foreign direct investment, and create meaningful jobs for the region. We really do this with the generous support of our partners and associates, mainly the European Union, which we are currently working with them in implementing the regional private sector development program under the 11th European Development Fund and a specific trade and private sector component that we do for the Haiti Dominican Republic Binational Cooperation Program.
Okay. All right. So that's a lot there, and that's wonderful stuff.
Yes.
So how did this come about, and how is this just the first one?
So actually, we have been doing these Caribbean investment forums. We've had smaller Caribbean investments taking place just this year at the tail end of Expo Dubai. We actually organized a smaller Caribbean investment forum in Dubai, where we really had the opportunity to bring in all of the investment promotion agencies from around the Caribbean to showcase what are the projects that are ready for foreign investment capital. This one is the first one that we're doing big, and we're doing it in the region because we really feel that, particularly after the 2 years that we've had post-COVID, supply chains, geopolitical issues, we really need to showcase from the region to the world what is the innovation that is taking place in our region, but also what are the opportunities for business and the future. This forum, the tagline is building a smarter and greener Caribbean. And that's exactly what we hope to do.
Yeah. All right. So let's talk more about that. And that, as you said, your theme for the event. What are we hoping to accomplish with the forum exactly?
So with the forum, what we're looking to do is create an event that is really solely focused on business opportunities. Many of the events that take place that talk about the development issues and trying to highlight and give some sort of thought leadership are really opportunities to showcase and talk. This is what we really want this forum to be, is a place for business people to come and talk to business people and do what they do best, create opportunity. We expect around 400 participants to come and hear details about the dynamic agenda for business-focused opportunities that are coming up, not just from Caribbean Export, but also from the investment promotion agencies and the different organizations that are really bringing forth transformational change to the region. We are partnering with the Caribbean Development Bank, the CARICOM Secretariat. We're partnering with the government of Trinidad and Tobago, and really look, and the European Union, really looking to come in together and bringing a development agenda, and that's really what it's encompassing about. It's going to be 3 days us talking about opportunities and really giving the opportunity for countries to highlight what are the projects that are of strategic importance and ready for FDI influx. Mm-hmm.
Smarter, greener Caribbean. Are we seeing this? Is it just talk? Are people really serious? Are countries serious? Or does it depend on, is it pockets in countries? What are we really looking at when we say this?
So what we're looking at is really highlighting four important sectors that definitely have an impact in the what's going to be the new chapter and what the economic development for the Caribbean is going to be. That is ag tech, renewable energy, transportation and logistics, and digital businesses. These past 2 years showed us how important these four pillars are in terms of building regional resilience, establishing long-term jobs, and really championing the sustainable development. The particularly in terms of ag tech, and we have to understand that the Caribbean is one of the most climate vulnerable regions in the world. So keeping food sustainability and particularly keeping food security is definitely going to be a big part of what we're going to be talking in the next couple of decades. And how do we influx technology to be able to maximize our agricultural output is definitely going to be key. Renewable energy, we definitely have seen, and you probably have felt it at the pump, you know, as the way we're going and how political, geopolitical issues unfold, we really become very susceptible to energy price fluctuations. This can all be somewhat cushioned with the influx of renewable energy sources and generation. Transportation and logistics has always been a challenge for us here in the Caribbean. So, as you know, sometimes it's cheaper for us to fly to Miami than between the islands.
Yep.
So definitely the way how we see this is bringing in partners that are able to help us tackle these challenges through foreign direct investment is the way forward, how we see really tackling the issues at hand.
I'm looking at the list of some speakers, some impressive speakers. Tell us about who's going to be presenting and the format of the forum over these few days.
So how we are structuring the Caribbean Investment Forum is really to be almost like a three-day event where you will be able to not only hear what are the new in what is coming up in the innovation agenda in the Caribbean, also giving space for businesses to interact and have those meaningful one-to-ones that actually generate business. So we'll start off with a very warm Caribbean hello on November 8th. We'll have an opening ceremony. And then the opening ceremony on the first day will actually be led by the leaders of our political landscape. We'll have our executive director, Deodat Maharaj, the secretary general of CARICOM, the ambassador to the European Union, and the honorable Paula Gopi-Schoon, minister of trade and industry for the government of Trinidad and Tobago, who have been a major partner in us taking on this event during this time. The government of Trinidad and Tobago has provided us with great support and a great landscape for us to really talk business and bring forward what we want to do. And then those that I mentioned you, the four different area subjects will really take over the agenda as we will be able to create like a CEO roundtable to talk about private sector engagement in the Caribbean, and that have separate panel discussions to talk about how do we move forward in these four pillars. On top of all this, we are going to be having B2B meeting with investors, and then each investment promotion agency from each country will have the chance to actually go into and pitch what are the projects that are open for business in their respective jurisdictions. So it's really coming together a business-to-business agenda with an investment promotion agenda to be able to deliver everything that we've been wanting to discuss to bring forward a new chapter of development in the Caribbean.
So who can attend? Is it just the countries or individuals within the countries can attend? How does that work exactly?
So registration is still open, and I urge all of your listeners to really visit CaribbeanInvestmentForum.com and try to get the last tickets that we have available. This event is really geared for anybody that is interested in talking business and doing business. So it's open for medium and small corporations that are looking for other opportunities in the Caribbean, for investors, particularly those investors that are already located in the Caribbean or from abroad, to come and hear opportunities. And also from folks that are looking to learn more about what policies are being put in place to deliver on the development goals that we have as a region.
Okay. And are there fees to be a part of it? What tell us about that side of it, how that works exactly.
So currently we have our general admission for the whole 3 days at $500 US. But if you can go into our website and see the agenda day by day and see which speakers call to you. And if you just want to register for a day, you have that option for $150 US each day.
All right. And at the end of the forum, what will be the next steps? What do we anticipate will be the action plan when it's all done?
We will definitely be ready in terms of how are we moving forward and building a more resilient Caribbean together in a partnership, not just with public sector, but a public and private partnership that delivers on the needs and goals that the private sector has. Caribbean Side Sport mandate has always been private sector development. So this is really looking to create a roadmap on how do we create the founding pillars that will enable us to go forward triumphantly for the next 50 years.
Okay. Hi. This sounds very exciting. Leo Naut, Deputy Executive Director with the Caribbean Export Development Agency and the Caribbean Investment Forum, November 8th through 11th in Trinidad and Tobago in Port of Spain. Thank you, sir, for being here with us this morning. Appreciate the conversation.
Thank you very much, Dwight, and I hope to see you all in Port of Spain, Trinidad, from November 8th to the 11th.
Go ahead. We're going to take a break and then be back to wrap things up. This is Morning Blend Business on Guardian Radio 96.9.
The Access Accelerator Small Business Development Center is here to help small businesses throughout the entire Bahamas. To better serve you, we've made it easier to contact us. Call 461-7232, WhatsApp 359-0626 or 359-2394, email helpdesk@sbdcbahamas.com, helpcenter@accessaccelerator.org. The Access Accelerator, empowering small business.
Ready to save? You can put $100 into the CFAL Savings Express plan and make sure your money keeps growing. Earn interest on your savings while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL, growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
It is time for your morning business report, brought to you by CFAL, pointing to a recent boom in real estate. Central Bank Governor John Rolls says private sector foreign currency inflows through commercial banks are on course to surpass pre-pandemic records. He said foreign exchange inflows were up 40% for the first 9 months of the year compared to the same period in 2021, leading to a sustained $3 billion in foreign reserves. He says this reflects the added impulse from significant and rising foreign investment flows in areas such as residential real estate and tourism infrastructure, which have both stimulated construction activities. He says over the first 9 months of 2022, measured forex inflows have increased by 40% in comparison to 2021. Citing a more evolved sector, the central bank also announcing yesterday that it will lift the moratorium on license applications for businesses that offer money transmission and payment services. In December 2019, the central bank imposed its moratorium on any new non-bank payment service providers and money transmission businesses to saturate the market. Governor Rolls saying yesterday that with the pandemic conditions abated, this subsector is in a better position to establish a stable footing and provide expanded services to the Bahamian public. You can read more about this in today's Guardian Business section. Applications for loans across financial lending institutions increasing by 5.7% for the first half of 2022 compared to the same period in 2021. That's according to the most recent data from the Bank Lending Overview. In total, lending institutions processed 14,532 loan applications, reflecting increased demand for consumer loans and mortgages. The central bank stating that only 79.4% of loans were approved, though. Consumer loan applications continue to dominate, representing 88% of the total, 83.4% of which were approved. Most loan denials were due to high debt service ratios, underemployment, and insufficient time on the job. In the mortgage market, the number of applications received grew by 1.9% when compared with the first half of 2021, and commercial financing constituted 5% of requests. Demand for commercial credit for the first half of 2021. And the Bahamas Hotel and Tourism Association and other tourism stakeholders meeting with executives from BPL to discuss their concerns. This meeting happened yesterday, coming as the newly implemented fuel charge increases, which will be reflected in this month's bill. Hotels and other large electricity consumers will be expected to pay 4 cents more per kilowatt hour this quarter, with the rate increasing again every quarter for the next year by 4 cents. The BHTA saying in a statement that ultimately the group sought to provide recommendations to BPL for ways to potentially mitigate the effect of the increases, as businesses still recovering from COVID will encounter significant financial challenges if they must face an increase in the second highest expense item alongside other looming increases to the cost of doing business in the country. It says that during the meeting, BPL executives provided attendees with a comprehensive presentation outlining BPL's short-term, mid- and long-term plans to address the rising cost of oil and their strategies to address power disruptions in both New Providence and the Family Islands. You can read more about this story in today's Guardian Business section. Overseas from the U.S. this week as it announces what's expected to be another substantial three-quarter point hike in its key interest rate, its fourth straight. Fed officials will likely engage in a fraught debate over whether it may soon be time to slow its rate hikes, which are intended to cool the worst inflation in four decades, but are also raising the risk of a recession. At a news conference after the Fed's last meeting, Chair Jerome Powell could signal a forthcoming shift come Wednesday to smaller rate increases. Doing so would give officials time to assess the impact of hikes. Powell won't explicitly spell out the Fed's likely next moves, but economists say he could acknowledge that officials are discussing a downshift to a half-point rate increase in December. The Fed's hikes have already led to much costlier borrowing rates for Americans, ranging from mortgages to auto and business loans. In your Market Watch recapping trading on the BISX from Monday, the BISX closing at 2,585.40, down 0.22. That's your Market Watch, and that is your Morning Business Report, brought to you by CFAL, growing wealth for future generations. And that is going to do it for Morning Blend Business on this Tuesday morning, first day of November. We'll be back tomorrow morning with more business news following Morning Blend right here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn, have a great day, everybody. Stay tuned for On the Clock with Aaron Green coming up next. Wake up today. Wake up. It's a new day.